and settle down. We've got a very busy agenda. Yep, go right ahead. I know. Oh, yeah. Okay, if we could all rise, and if you would join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Eva Henry, Eric Hansen, Bill Holland,
here.
Elise Jones,
here.
David Beacom,
here.
Tim Mock, Tom Hayden,
here.
Chrissy Fanganello, Anthony Graves,
here.
Robin Kneach, Kevin Flynn,
here.
Roger Partridge,
here.
Gail Watson, Don Rozier,
present.
Bob Pfeiffer,
here.
Bob Roth, Renee Peterson, Jim Peters, Larry Vittem, David Spellman, Aaron Brockett, oh, sorry, Suzanne Jones.
Here.
Ann Justin.
Here.
Lynn Baca, George Teal, Paul Donahue, Kathy Noon.
Here.
Ron Engels, Catherine Hyder, Laura Christman.
Here.
Gail Christie, Richard Champion, Rick Teeter.
Here.
Debbie Nasta, Carl Randolph, Steve Conklin.
Here.
Joe Jefferson.
Here.
Dan Woog. Mark Gruber. Daniel Dick.
Present.
George Heath. Samantha Meering. Lisa Jones. Laura Brown. Henry Ergot. Lynette Kelsey.
Here.
Paula Bovo. Doris Rigoni. Sarah Shakaris Graves.
Here.
Ron Rakowski.
Here.
Mike Hillman.
Here.
Brad Weasley.
Here.
Shakti.
Here.
Jerry Bean, Phil Cernanek.
Present.
Jackie Millay.
Here.
Joan Peck. Ashley Stolzman.
Here.
John O'Brien. Connie Sullivan. Colleen Whitlow.
Here.
Deborah Jerome. Sean Forey. Chris Larson. Joe Gearlock. Kyle Mollica.
Here.
John Dyack.
Here.
Sally Daigle. Gary Howard. Rita Dozel.
Here.
Adam Mikowski. Eric Montoya.
Here.
Herb Atchison.
Here.
Joyce Jay. Gary Sanford. Deborah Perkins Smith.
Here.
Bill Van Meter.
Here.
And we do have a quorum.
We have a quorum. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Jackie Millay. I am the chair of the Denver Regional Council of Governments. I want to thank you for coming this evening to the January 20th, 2016, our first board meeting of the new year. This evening, the Denver Regional Council of Governments is holding a public hearing on proposed amendments to the 2040 Fiscally Constrained Regional Transportation Plan and the companion air quality conformity determination documents. This public hearing of the Denver Regional Council of Governments is hereby convened. The proposed amendments being considered tonight were requested by project sponsors through DRCOG's 2015 Cycle 2 Plan Amendment process. The purpose of this hearing is to provide an opportunity for all who are interested in the 2040 Fiscally Constrained Regional Transportation Plan and proposed amendments to provide comments to the board. No decisions will be made and no actions will be taken tonight related to this public hearing. Receiving public comment is important to the board's decision-making process. Anyone wishing to speak should register on the sign-in sheets on the table in the reception area, or should have previously made a request to speak through the DRCOG website or by phone. All comments via email, website, or in writing are automatically included in the public hearing record. any received prior to this meeting have been provided to the board. If you wish to submit written testimony to be included in the official record of the hearing, please give it to the secretary after you speak. Connie Garcia, sitting to my right. Board members are free to ask questions of those testifying. Jacob Rieger of the DRCOG staff will now summarize the proposed amendments and the results of the companion air quality conformity determinations. Mr. Rieger.
Madam Chair, members of the board, thank you very much. The proposed amendments primarily include modifications to existing roadway projects that are already in the 2040 fiscally constrained regional transportation plan, such as projects on C-470, I-70 East, and Tower Road, plus some new locally funded projects requested by local governments, such as the ramp from Tower Road onto westbound Pena Boulevard. The locations of the proposed amendments are shown in this map up on the screen, and they're described in this table, both of which are from the summary document that's included in the board packet and has been made available as part of this public hearing. DRCOG must also show that the fiscally constrained regional transportation plan, as amended, will not violate federal air quality conformity standards. The 2040 regional transportation plan's transportation networks with the proposed amendments were modeled for air quality conformity analysis by the State Air Pollution Control Division. All pollutant emission tests were passed, as demonstrated in the two companion air quality conformity documents that have also been made available as part of this public hearing. Thank you.
The hearing is now open for those who have signed up to speak. Each speaker will have up to 3 minutes to testify. If you have not finished by the end of the 3 minutes, I will ask you to conclude your remarks. We respectfully ask that you not repeat specific points made by prior speakers. A simple statement of agreement with prior testimony is accepted and appreciated. When you hear your name called, please approach the microphone area and be ready to testify as soon as the preceding speaker is finished. At this point, I just have one individual who has signed up for public comments, Becky English from the Sierra Club. Thank you, Ms. English.
There, now are we on? Good evening. Last year, DRCOG amended the RTP to add the I-70 expansion project. At that time, the Sierra Club submitted comments asking DRCOG to carefully consider the health impacts to the residents and communities and students in schools adjacent to the proposed expansion to I-70 through North Denver. We submitted data from Denver Environmental Health showing a significantly higher incidence of the diseases linked to highway pollution among the residents of these communities and the availability of operational control measures to reduce emissions from the project by nearly 40%. Specifically, the club asked DRCOG to evaluate and adopt a mitigation strategy that would divert heavy trucks from the I-70 corridor between Brighton Boulevard and Colorado Boulevard. The effect of this operational measure would be to allow long-distance trucks traveling through the metro area to use I-76 and 270, and trucks seeking access to local destinations between Brighton Boulevard and Colorado Boulevards to disperse using local streets. The effect would be to locally remove all of the emissions from interstate and cross-state truck trips from the adjacent neighborhoods. Research submitted to both CDOT and Federal Highway Administration officials show a strong correlation between exposure to highway pollution and asthma attacks, especially among children, and deaths from cardiovascular disease. Denver Environmental Health found that these effects occur disparately among residents near I-70. The final EIS does not evaluate or respond to the recent health effects research submitted by the club to CDOT and FHWA in SDEIS comments, nor does the FEIS even mention the most recent research discussed in person with Director Batt, and FHWA officials last summer. These most recent research reports confirm EPA's earlier finding that exposure to PM2.5 emitted from highways is directly linked to increased incidence of asthma and cardiovascular mortality. In addition, a California study shows that carbon particles emitted from trucks are the most responsible entity for increased mortality from heart disease. We submit these reports to you tonight. We also urge you to consider another study we submit showing that the rate of cardiovascular deaths declined significantly where annual 2.5 concentrations were reduced by 3 micrograms per cubic meter over 10 years. An analysis of multiple risk factors in addition to improved air quality demonstrated that most of the observed reduction in cardiovascular deaths was associated with the lower pollution concentrations. This study shows that you have it in your power to save lives among the residents of Globeville, Elyria, Swansea. Given that neither CDOT nor FHWA has considered this research or undertaken any investigation of the relationship between the disparate health outcomes observed in GES neighborhoods and emissions from I-70, the club asks that Dr. Cog undertake this investigation and give serious consideration to protecting these residents. I mistimed my comments, so I do have a written form here that I'll submit to you.
Thank you very much, Ms. English. Is there anyone else? There's no one else that has signed up. Is there anyone else in the audience wishing to speak on this issue? Okay. I will ask the board members if there are any questions. Going once? Okay. This brings tonight's public hearing to a close. Thank you for your testimony and your interest. The board is currently scheduled to take action on the proposed amendments to the 2040 fiscally constrained regional transportation plan at their March meeting, which is the third Wednesday of the month. So thank you very much. Moving back to our agenda, I am now going to ask for a move to approve our agenda this evening. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. We have an agenda. We're going to start with a report of the chair. RTC did not meet, the Regional Transportation Commission did not meet in December because of inclement weather. We had a fairly hefty agenda at yesterday's meeting. I'm going to briefly review. RTC concurred with the board actions that were taken in December, which were the distribution of the remaining $50,000 of the fiscal year 2017 Station Area Master Plan Urban Center to Denver for the North Capitol Hill Colfax Urban Center study. And RTC also concurred with the protocol and project waiting list for any possible 2016-2021 TIP funds, which we would love if any became available. RTC also discussed a number of issues that are on our agenda tonight. The TIP project delays for fiscal year 2015, and they accepted those. There was a discussion of amendments to the 2016-21 Transportation Improvement Plans program. We will be taking that up later this evening. RTC, actually, one of the projects was pulled from that amendment process, and we're going to discuss that with you, the reasons why and what action will be taken on that. The other two, which were the regarding just a funding change, were passed by the RTC, and we'll get into that in our discussion. RTC also confirmed the 7 special interest seats on the Transportation Advisory Committee. We also got an actually very interesting briefing from Mr. Rieger on freight movement, which I think at some point will be very worthwhile for this board to hear as well. I am now going to turn my time over to Mr. Bob Pfeiffer from the Mayor Pro Tem from the City of Arvada, who's going to give us an update on the structure and governance work. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Today, I want to discuss a little bit of what the Structure and Governance Committee has been doing for quite some time, but more importantly, our proposed structure changes that the Governance and Structure Committee is going to be proposing next month for a vote. If you look at Attachment A, it's real simplistic visual, but it's good to start thinking about it today.
It's Attachment B, excuse me, Bob.
Sorry, did I say A? B. It's just to get this board to start thinking about doing our business a little bit different. Today, when you look at the first page of that attachment, obviously the board's on top. We have an admin committee, and then we have our officers at the bottom of a triangle. We're proposing to take that leadership structure and changing it a little bit more to gain a broader engagement by the board. Also to increase maybe some of the membership of the admin So what we're proposing is that the admin committee is broken up into two new committees. One is the Finance and Budget Committee, and the other one is the Performance and Engagement Committee. So we're basically taking the admin committee functions and actually putting them into two groups. And I've listed, or we've listed, some of the tasks that would be assigned to those committees. Within the Finance and Budget Committee, which would be chaired by the treasurer, we would review major contracts, grants, expenditures. We'll manage audits, make recommendations on all budget-related items for the Board of Directors, and provide regular updates to the board. So one proposal is that when we do those updates at the end of the board meeting, that committee would chime in. The Performance and Engagement Committee would be chaired by the secretary, and that committee would recommend appointments of the executive director to the board of directors, hold quarterly meetings, work a little bit closer with the executive director on some of the tasks that have been signed through her evaluation and so forth, recommend policy and procedures, implement and review the structure governance. So once the structure and governance committee has come to a conclusion, because it is an ad hoc committee, we would see that this committee would continue holding the flag and making sure that the structure and governance makes sense and kind of do a checkpoint every so often. And then obviously oversee member orientation and provide regular updates to the board meeting, just like the other committee. And then we'd introduce and formalize the officers into an executive committee, which any type of structure that would be normally an executive committee. That is a non-decision-making body. It's just more of discussing what's on the board of the board agenda, conflict resolution, process guidance, and then receives updates from the other committees. No decision would ever be made in those committees. The other two, the Finance, Budget, Performance, and Engagement Committee would. So it is a different way of doing business. Kind of to expand a little bit about engagement, each group would grow a little bit. So we would add about four additional board members to each of those committees. So we would actually increase to about 8 more members than we would in the admin. So if somebody's interested in finance more than the administration of the organization, we can have board members apply to that committee and give a more in-depth insight into the budget process. But if folks are more interested in how we govern and structure and how we engage, those board members can jump into that function committee. So this is just to get it out there. We spent most of the holidays, thanks to Phil making us work over the holidays. Elise and I, and I know a few of us were here working on the holidays to get it to this point. The structure committee did finalize it this month, and we just want the board to start thinking about it. So next steps, we'd like to have a webinar, because that seems to be a little bit easier for folks to work from their office or wherever they're at, to go into depth of what this really means here in the next 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Within the next week or two, we have our legal staff reviewing the proposed structure changes to make sure our bylaws and everything we're governing is, how does this impact us, what has to change. I mean, there's a lot of change because we refer to admin in a lot of documents. So hopefully when we have the webinar, we'll have the legal readout on it and what needs to happen. We can discuss that in the webinar. We'll hopefully have one or two of those. I think Phil has volunteered to host them. It's on the record now. It's recorded. Second. He talks anyway.
Point of order.
So, and then what we will do is we will get a frequent asked questions and answer kind of document out prior to the board meeting of next month. And then our goal would be is to make the motion to move forward with this structure, starting with the new board of the new officers. So the March-April time frame would be nice. It's kind of a swift change, but I think it's appropriate to do the change at the beginning of a new officers. So
thank you, Bob. I would actually like every board member who is participating in the structure and governance, just raise your hand so the rest of the members can have an understanding of who's been involved in drafting some of this. And we do have a fairly lengthy agenda, so I am actually not going to have Bob entertain questions right now so we can get to the rest of this. But I think the webinar will actually will actually give us a lot more detail and opportunity for dialogue. I do want to welcome some new members that we have this evening. It's always wonderful to welcome new members and sad to say goodbye to some members who are leaving. So I do want to point out it's Suzanne Jones's last meeting with us as a board member. And Suzanne, I just want to thank you for your service at the DRCOG board table and being a great collaborator. And your new member from Boulder has big shoes to fill. So thank you. And can we all give Suzanne a round of applause for her service? I'd like to say you're moving on to bigger and better things, but it's just being the mayor of Boulder, so. No, and congrats, and best of luck with that. No, that's a great job. So the new member starting next month from Boulder will be Aaron Brockett, and I believe Aaron is here, and going to stand up and say hello. And then to your right is the alternate, Matt Applebaum. And Matt's been around for a long time, so I know everybody already knows who he is. But thank you. Welcome, Matt. From Dakota, we have a new alternate this evening who is not here, Carl Randolph. From Edgewater, we have a new member who is here, Stephen Conklin. Stephen, welcome. The new alternate from Golden is here, and Casey Brown. Poor Casey actually came to a structure and governance meeting, so he gets a little extra applause. New alternate from Westminster, Emma Pinter, who is not here. Oh, you are here. I apologize. Emma. Well, I'm glad. Welcome. A new member, I believe, from Sheridan, Sally Daigle. Yep. Welcome, Sally. First time here, Eric Montoya from Thornton. Okay, see, I can't count. Thank you, Eric. Welcome again. Sorry, apologize. And first time for Mayor Mike Hillman from Idaho Springs. Yes? Well, that's not. I was misinformed.
It feels like.
Misinformed by. You do not need to fall on that sword. But, well, welcome anyway. And glad you made the drive. So thank you. Thank you. Yeah. I'll just put that in your owe me one category. Okay, one of the privileges that I get to have as the board chair, and this is, looks like it's going to be my last one, is to honor those of us who have sat at this table for 5 years. And usually I make some joke about dog years, and I realize that was getting old. And those of you who know me pretty well know I love Saturday Night Live. So Saturday Night Live has a five-timers club for people who have hosted the show for five times. So I will admit to being a member of that, and we also have Mayor Ron Rakowski is a member of that five-timers club. Is there anyone else that has received their five-year service award that I'm missing? Well, I want to welcome the newest member for the five-year service award, Commissioner Don Rozier from Jefferson County, and thank him.
Thanks.
Welcome to the club. And
we're going
to. Yeah, that's right.
Here we go.
Here, we'll get up. We'll get away from the chair. Sorry, guys.
Oh, you were trying to dance there, huh?
We are dancing. It's part of the club.
Secret handshake.
Thank you. Congratulations. Well, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Let me get you the box for that.
Yes.
So, you have something to throw darts at when you're frustrated with Dr.
Cog. Oh, with the new logo.
That's right. You're the first official recipient. So again, thank you, thank you, thank you for your service. Okay, the fun is now over. We are moving on to the report of the executive director.
Okay. Michelle. Thank you. So I'm going to refer everyone to attachment D before I get into too deep into my report. I wanted to bring to your attention. I was asked by a member of the board about initiating meetings to discuss.
So it's attachment C, excuse me. Oh, it's attachment C, not in your packets.
Oh, okay, you're right. I pulled it out of attachment C and put it with attachment D. You're right.
I just want everyone to know where we are.
Pardon me for that. Attachment C. I was contacted by a board member who was interested in finding out, was there any issues or challenges associated with pulling a group of DRCOG member, staff, et cetera, together to meet before board meetings. And I asked them to please kind of hold off on doing anything until I talk with legal counsel. And so Council did provide an opinion. It's there. It's the entire indented piece there. I'm not going to read this to you. I'm sure you've already read through it, but the bottom line is that legal counsel did say that he thought that a pre-board meeting of a few members to discuss an upcoming agenda had to be open to the public. That assumed that at least three people were participating in that. He recommended against pre-meetings of three or more board members unless there was notice given and meetings were open to the public. So I don't know if anyone has any questions or concerns about that, but this is more, you know, this is from the attorney, not me, but I'll answer whatever questions you have if I can.
Mr. Pfeiffer.
Well, I do have a question because, I mean, we do have our normal meetings, and I think those are all public and mm-hmm. noticed and everything else. Is I know there's discussion in certain areas or regions where it could be board members from here getting together to talk about maybe upcoming agendas or items. So that applies to that as well.
It does.
Okay. Okay. I just needed to make sure I was crystal clear on that. I know there's talks of groups doing that.
Right. And that was what came to me was thinking about doing this. Do you see any concerns or challenges, whatever? And that's when I talked with counsel. And he did. He and I talked. I sent him an email, and then he and I talked, and I explained, as I understood it, there was an opportunity, or people were considering making time to have board members within their sub area of the region to get together and talk about issues coming up on the agenda. And did I see any concerns with that?
I know there's a discussion around maybe talking about, you know, regional parts of DRCOG mm-hmm. issues, you know, that are maybe more specific to that area, and so it might behoove a few folks to get together to talk about those issues. And if those groups were to proceed, I mean, we probably need to talk about that as a board or anything else, right? Because I'm sure there's
also... Are you talking about having sub-regional meetings?
Yeah,
just to,
yeah.
And in
absolutely.
Fact, that is... well, first I'll say that the onboarding program that we're preparing to implement now that you approved it will include some sub-regional meetings. I don't know that we'll get to every area of the region over the next year, but we're certainly going to work towards that. But the bottom line is, if you're having a meeting, just notice it.
Okay.
I think that that's the best thing. Let us know so that we can notice it here, especially if you're going to be talking about DRCOG business, and we can put it in the books. It's there. Folks, we go through a process every year where we lay out where we're going to notice meetings. So just let us know, and we'll notice it. And
right, so the point isn't that the meetings can't happen. The meetings need to be noticed, and we need to just inform staff when they're happening so they can be properly noticed, and we're conforming with the open meeting law.
Yeah, and you probably need an agenda, too.
Yep.
So I think it's...
In my jurisdiction, our city attorney told us we had to give 24 hours prior notice. What is your number? 24 hours? Got
it. Hours... maybe like 48.
Instead of us guessing, I'm going to suggest that we actually just confirm it with the attorney, and we will make sure we send that information out via email to the board so we know.
So if we do go down this, I'd like to formalize this. I would like to see minutes and notes from other groups if there are subgroups meeting, you know. So if we do, I don't know what the interest is. There might be none, but if there is, I hopefully the board of directors will formalize a process in which we can have sub-regional meetings?
So there is a process included in attachment G, and it will be formalized this evening. DRCOG staff recommends designating the reception area of the DRCOG offices as the official location for posting notices, and then there's a summary associated with it. So
not just the process in which we notify the public. I'm talking about, you know, I don't know if we it's an ad hoc committee that's not been blessed by the board that's meeting as a subgroup, not as a collective group. So if there is any thoughts of doing a regional group, I'm just saying like northern Denver area or the western Denver area, that shouldn't we as a board decide and look into what those mean and how those should operate, and or should it be just okay for people to get together and talk all day long? Okay, I'm getting a lot of heads shaking yes and no, so.
I think we've got some, well, we've got, I think we're opening a little conversation here, which I'm going to indulge for about 5 minutes, and at some point we're going to maybe move this to an agenda item. I think we've got a hefty agenda tonight, so, but I do think this is an important discussion, so please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You know, out south we are kind of meeting informally, you know, and there is a lot of crossover in the DRCOG board, but, you know, it's not specifically to discuss DRCOG matters. You know, I'd wonder if best practice for us would be to go ahead and just, you know, notice post it so that at least, you know, that's out there for public consumption. But, you know, my preference is not to, you know, again, you know, our meetings are not DRCOG specific. And so, you know, I don't know if Ron or some others who attend those might want to comment as well. But
Mayor Rakowski.
I would point out that the Colorado Court of Appeals, and I believe it was affirmed by the Supreme Court, said that if you have a gathering of officials which is in effect social is not required to be posted. Is that right, Commissioner? Yeah, which is, I think, up to the decision of the people participating, not someone else.
The executive director has a comment.
Yeah, I would refer you to the basically the last paragraph of council's.
Your mic's not on. Here we go.
Oh, I'm sorry. Refer you to the last paragraph of council's opinion where it says the OML is construed liberally to further its policy declaration that formation of public policy is public business and may not be conducted in secret. Further successful plaintiffs in an OML case are entitled to award of costs and reasonable attorney fees. There's I'm not sure where it is, but there's language in here too about back up in the first paragraph it says the Colorado Supreme Court has held that that if the meeting is rationally connected to the policymaking responsibilities of the public body holding or attending the meeting, then the meeting is subject to the OML. So I would just suggest that everyone use their best judgment in doing in having these meetings, and if you want to be really safe, let us know. We'll post it where DRCOG meetings are normally posted. And if you want to take it any further than that, I don't want to create any more work for structure governance, but maybe it's something for them to roll around in their heads.
Okay. Jennifer, you want to continue on, or is that you were just starting?
I know. let's see. What else can I tell? We did a survey. Shockingly, 41 people participated, which is great. Great for DRCOG to have 41 people to participate in a survey. Unfortunately, you had a lot of choices. So, but the survey on when to hold the new work session that we're hoping to start in March, the date and time that was preferred by most of the respondents, the most respondents, was the first Wednesday at 4:00. Again, the officers actually are suggesting that maybe the structured governance sort of look at what the operating rules for the structured governance group might look like. So with that, I'll just move on to the next item. I'll call your attention now to attachment D. In there is a report that I've been providing to the administrative committee for 2 or 3 months, and actually it's going to get changed up pretty quick. You're going to hear later tonight from Jerry Stiegel, who's our director of organizational development, to talk about the balanced scorecard and reporting on that. So this report is going to change even more. It's going to look more like a dashboard than a lot of text that you see right now. There will be narrative if you want to look at it, but again, Jerry will go through that with you. But there were just a few things that I wanted to point out in there. On the first page under Outcome 1, Initiative 1, I've been having a lot of meetings one-on-one with board members and some alternates. I'm not going to go through all of these, but I just want to call your attention to the fact that there weren't any real, a lot of common threads or real themes to all of the meetings that I've had recently, but there were some things I think of that are noteworthy in there and may have an impact on how well the board operates. So I'll just call your attention to that, read it later. I don't want to take up a lot of time here. And as you heard from the board chair, we have a lot of new members and alternates. So my initial focus was on primarily on members of the administrative committee. I'm now switching over to new members. I'll get around to everyone before the year is out, but there's a lot of you and just one of me. So I'll be working on that throughout the year. But the new focus right now is on brand new members to try to help them get acclimated to their new role on the board. We had about 25 board members stay after the board meeting last month for the staff open house. It was a great time. I know that members learned a lot from the staff, and we're looking forward to doing more of those sorts of things going forward. As I mentioned a moment ago, the onboarding program is slated to begin soon. We're working really hard to get that up and going over the next month or two, and hope that that will be a way to, again, help new members and alternates get acclimated to their role on the board sooner than later. Let's see, I mentioned a minute ago that you're going to be hearing from Jerry Stiegel about the balanced scorecard. Staff has been working really hard with Jerry for, I don't know, seems like forever, but I guess maybe it's been about a year and a half, 2 years. We've been working on putting the balanced scorecard together. We finished up with that just a little bit early. Again, you're going to hear about that later this evening. One of the things that I've heard, especially in my last performance evaluation, how important it was for board members to get agenda materials early so that they had time to prepare for meetings. The ask from the board was to have materials at least a week in advance. We have 100% compliance with that, with the exception of an attachment for actually the structure governance committee back in November. So you asked for 7 days advance information, and you're getting it. Just a couple of other things I'll point out. We have we've only had a few communities take advantage of Dr. Cog's grant finder. This is an opportunity for you to find money out there from both the public and the private sector. So if you're, especially if you're a small community, don't have a lot of staff, this is a great opportunity for you. There is no charge to you. It's covered by your dues and just the work that staff does for you. So if that looks like something that would be helpful for you, please let Connie or I know, and we'll get you in touch with the appropriate staff. And then there's a bunch of handouts tonight at the table. So the really boring looking handouts are bills. These are bills that were introduced in the legislature since the agenda was mailed out. Unfortunately, this is going to happen all throughout the session. Again, we promised you you'd get your information 7 days in advance, but when bills are dropping in between the agenda being mailed and the board meeting, we'll send it to you as quickly as we can, but some days it's going to be the day of the meeting. We have our lobbyists at these meetings. We have our in-house lobbyists as well, Rich Mara. So we'll go through those things and help you get acquainted with these things, but I just want to point out we're in session and this stuff comes pretty quick because they meet for a short time once a year. The next thing I want to point out is the Dr. Cog Award Celebration. Please get this on your calendar. There's an opportunity to submit projects and programs that are going on within your community. There's an opportunity to submit suggestions for the John V. Christensen Memorial Award. This is Dr. Cog's highest honor, so please take a look at that after you leave this evening. The other document I want to call your attention to is this notice about a data request. We really depend on your staff to get us data and information about what's going on in your community. This is how we put together a great travel model, great land use modeling, how we make good projections. We couldn't do this without your staff. So whether it's working with your city or county manager or your peers, please talk with your staff about helping us collect this data, because it really is critical to all the inputs and modeling that we do here at DRCOG to help you make informed decisions. There's a brand new list of roster, list of members and alternates at the table tonight. There is a notice about a rescheduling an event. This event on aging and housing was scheduled for December 15th. We had to postpone it due to inclement weather, but I would highly suggest you and your staff, if you can, to attend this. It's January 26th. All the information is there on the back. This is a big, big issue. I've talked with staff a lot recently about this. We're getting calls all the time about from seniors or loved ones of seniors who are running into a real problem because rents are going up and seniors are being kicked out of their homes, which generally just puts people into facilities prematurely. So there's also norms of conduct. I'll just point that out. It's at the table this evening too. And then finally, there is MetroVision milestones. You'll hear a little bit more about these in a presentation later on, but this is a nice takeaway for you, just to kind of put in your packet of DRCOG's stuff to kind of help remind you of where we've been and where we're going and what's up next. So that's it.
And I forgot. I was remiss in pointing out that we have a couple celebrities among us this evening. I don't know if you all can see this, but the Villager Men and Women of the Year, Mayor Kathy Noon and Mayor Ron Rakowski. So,
stand up.
They couldn't have made better choices unless they picked someone from Lone Tree. No. It's my understanding there are autographed copies may be made available if you speak to the right people.
Madam Chair, I would add that don't forget to read my column in there.
Oh, okay. All right. You can do your and plug. Jackie, you get your plug at the end.
Jackie, yes. We would have had you, but then we would have had to notice the meeting. Oh.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that, Kathy. Thank you. All right. Moving back to the real business at hand, we're moving on to agenda item number 8, the 2016 State Legislative Preview, Attachment E in your packet. Mr. Ed Bowditch from Tomlinson and Associates. Oh, and Jennifer.
Thank you. And Jennifer's here.
Yes.
Yes. Thanks. Thank you so much, Madam Chair and members. We're going to give a brief overview of what's going on in the legislature so far. We have finished 8 days of the 120-day session. In your binders, I think you'll see our legislative outlook. That is the document we prepared on about January 1st. Looking forward, it's about a 15-page document. Looking forward, summarizing bills by subject area, has information on the key challenges facing the legislature. And you're welcome to share that with your friends and colleagues as well. I've also distributed a one-page, or it's coming around right now, green sheets with a one-page summary of what's going on in the legislature to date. I'm going to focus just a little bit on the budget. As many of you probably know, the state's economy is slowing down just a bit. Similar to many states around the country, Colorado is still in pretty good shape compared to many other states. But it is slowing down primarily in the natural resources area, slow down in the oil and gas drilling, in the extraction industries. So our income tax and sales tax revenues are coming down just a bit. That was evident in the December 20th revenue estimates and revenue forecasts. That also meant that our Tabor refund for next year is coming down just a bit, came down from the September revenue estimates. In fact, in the current year we're in, there is no forecasted Tabor refund for fiscal year 15-16. However, for next year is when the real fun begins. The budget process is constrained by Tabor revenue refunds. Tabor refunds, they're estimated at $192 million for 16-17. That will be modified at the March revenue estimates, but right now the state has to plan, set aside $192 million. Those would be refunds on the magnitude of $37 to $111, depending on your income bracket, per person, per taxpayer in Colorado. While the legislature is trying to address its budget fiscal thicket, as it's been called, its budgetary challenge with the Tabor refunds, Medicaid keeps increasing. The requirements for funding K-12 are still in the Constitution. So the legislature is in this box, if you will. Couple of things that have gone on of particular interest to Denver Regional Council of Governments so far. Just today, a few hours ago, the Legislative Joint Budget Committee voted 6-0 to approve the expenditure of $1.5 million for the senior services program. What am I calling it? The funding for seniors program. There is, in statute, the legislature funds the senior property tax exemption. If there is any money left over from that fund that was not claimed through the Senior and Disabled Veterans Property Tax Program, those savings, in effect, automatically get transferred to the State Department of Human Services. Today, the Budget Committee had to formally authorize the expenditure. It was tough. It took a lot of lobbying, not only by us, but the Department of Human Services. We called Rich. He called Jayla. I'd like to thank both of them for their very prompt response on waiting lists for services, the length of time some seniors are waiting to get a ride to the doctor, and so on. In the end, Pat Stedman, who has been a real champion for this, made the motion and said, this is what we have to do. So we were very pleased today. It still has to go through the legislative process, but it was 6-0 today at the JBC. The other funding item we're watching with the JBC that will take place in the next 2 months, you will remember that the legislature authorized a strategic plan for aging and appropriated first-year funding for that in last legislative session. There was also a funding request for year two for that, and the Department of Local Affairs did make that request, and we will be lobbying in support of that to continue the strategic plan on aging for next year. At this point, I'll turn it over to my colleague, Jennifer.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm Jennifer Castle, one of your other lobbyists. As Ed mentioned, we have had 8 days of the legislative session so far, so only 112 left, but who's counting? In that time, 230 bills have been introduced. There's 100 legislators. Each legislator gets to introduce 5 bills. Somehow at the end of session, that math adds up to 700 bills. So that's what we're expecting come May. A few legislative issues that we've been working on prior to the legislative session. I'll give you a little bit of an update on that. The first one, we've been working very proactively to introduce a joint memorial that will urge Congress to alter and or remove the hold harmless provision from the Older Americans Act. I'm sure you guys are all very familiar with that. We did get sign off from the Senate leadership today that they are okay with that. Last week we heard from House leadership that they are okay with that. So we are moving forward with that. It's going to be a bipartisan joint memorial that we're expecting to see introduced in the Senate, and hopefully we can get that passed as quickly as possible. The second issue is legislation to study transportation districts. I believe it was the last board meeting you all heard about a bill that was coming out of the Transportation Review Legislative Committee this summer and fall. The TLRC committee was looking at a bill that would alter the boundaries for the State Transportation Commission, which would have had a significant impact to the representation of Dr. Cog on the Transportation Commission. We were able to talk to the committee members and the bill sponsor, Rep. Terry Carver from down in the Colorado Springs area. We were able to talk her into altering that bill and turn it into a study to look at those Transportation Commission districts. Those haven't been studied since the early 1990s, so we recommended that if she could go in that route, that would be better. That bill has been introduced. I think it was introduced last week, and I know Rich is going to speak a little bit more on it, but that's House Bill 1018. And then the third issue is funding for transportation. We've had ongoing conversations about funding for transportation for the past couple of years. Last year, within probably the last week or so of session, a big bill known as Trans 2 was introduced, which would have allowed CDOT to bond for transportation projects. That bill was ultimately killed one of the last days of session. That bill is going to come back for this year. I believe this week the proponents of that bill are going to be gathering stakeholders to talk more broadly about the issue. So we do expect to see that come back, if not in the same form from last year, in something very similar. So Rich is going to talk to you about the other 230 bills that have been introduced. And look forward to tracking the bills all session long. So please let Ed or I know if you have any questions on anything. So thank you.
Before I call on the mayor, I will just open it up to the board to see if, are there any questions at this point? Okay, great. Mayor Cernanik. Councilmember Cernanik.
Jennifer, particularly on the joint memorial on the federal funding for aging that's there, knowing that our congressional group is fairly unified on this as well, getting the state legislature to take a position, what is the likelihood that you might say with regard to this actually being adopted from a federal perspective?
It being adopted from at the state level, the memorial? Or, I'm sorry, at the federal level?
Well, the Hold Harmless relates to
the federal
yes. allocation out of the Older Americans Act funds.
Right. Geez, I do not know what the federal government is going to do. I do know
what that... What do they pay you for?
Yeah.
I'm just kidding.
I can tell you that the chairman, I believe the ranking member of the committee at the federal level, are both states that are harmed by the Hold Harmless provision. So I know that with Colorado getting on board and hopefully some other states as well too, hopefully that will urge the federal government to act.
Thank you.
So, yep, absolutely.
Okay, Commissioner Jones.
I was wondering if you could give us an update on Senate Bill 228 funds and how the change in the Tabor refund might reflect or might impact what's predicted on that front.
Senate Bill 228 was passed in 1999 to guarantee a certain level of funding for transportation and state capital construction, given certain economic triggers. This will be the first year that those funds are allocated. And I don't have the specific, I'll have to catch you when I go back and look it up. I don't have the specific amounts, but when the Tabor refund limit goes down, typically the amount transferred will go up. And when the Tabor refund rises, the amount goes down. So those were projected to increase, if I remember correctly, and I hope nobody's writing this down, for transportation, maybe $100 million. It's not going to resolve all of the state's infrastructure by any means, infrastructure needs by any means.
It's 220, 16, 2017, it's $106 million. That includes the transit.
Okay. Yeah.
Are there any additional questions? Thank you very much for your report. Appreciate it. Okay, moving on to the agenda, item number 9, it's public comment. Up to 45 minutes is allocated at this time for public comment, and each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. If there are additional requests from the public to address the board, time will be allocated at the end of this meeting to complete public comment. I request that there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before this board. Consent and action items will begin immediately after the last speaker. Is there anyone here for public comment? Seeing none, I am going to close the floor, and we're going to move on to agenda item number 10, consent agenda. I'll look for a motion to approve our consent. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Thank you. Moving on to the action agenda. Number 11, a discussion of resolution amending the 2016-2021 Transportation Improvement Program, Attachment H, Mr. Todd Cottrell.
Thank you. So in your agenda, we have 3 amendments for your consideration, but I believe, Chair, you had mentioned the situation at RTC.
Thank you. Let me clarify, board members, for the first project title, RTD Route Number 324, Frequency Improvements, there was a question, there's a change in scope on this project. There was a question that was raised at RTC about whether or not the change in scope would actually accomplish the outcomes that were initially presented in the first. Initially, they were going to be increasing the weekday frequency of the bus route, and then from 30 minutes to 15. And now it's actually going to be extending weekday service hours and adding Sunday service. So there is a change in the project, and so we reached out to the project sponsor to ask about that, and we asked, would it be possible to delay this till next month? Would that create any difficulties? At the time, it was thought there were not going to be any project delays created by delaying this for 1 month. We've since learned that has changed. So I'm going to ask Mr. Cottrell to go forward with the other two, and then we're going to pick this one back up at the end of after we discuss the first two, with your indulgence. So please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. So the second amendment in your agenda is an amendment to update the scope and funding types and add funds for the I-25 North Managed Lanes Project, sponsored by CDOT Region 4. I would like to point out within the revised funding table in the bottom, there are two different colors. The recommendation from TAC was to just add the $25 million in loans, and that is highlighted in yellow. But however, since between TAC and RTC, staff was informed of a new request from CDOT Region 4 to add the items in green. The items in green include additions to the scope and the three new funding types, which are the bridge, the hazard elimination, and the water quality funds. Yesterday morning at RTC, the recommendation was for the complete amendment of all the items shown below in the revised funding table. The next amendment is to amend the C-470 Managed Toll Express Lane, sponsored by CDOT Region 1. This amendment would transfer funds between fiscal years and also change the loan from local to state, as it is backed by state funds. So those are the two amendments, and now we can move forth to the
I'm going to ask that we just, there are going to be different motions. If we could have discussion on these, if there's questions. If there are no questions, I would entertain a motion on these two.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Okay. Moving back now to the first project. Unfortunately, RTC did not act on this project, thinking that we did have an additional month to address the question that was raised. We have since learned that there is a time-sensitive issue here, and so we do need to act on this sooner, or it's actually going to delay implementation of this project until July, which is in no one's best interest. So I'm going to turn the floor over to Commissioner Jones, who is going to comment on a potential way we can move forward productively.
Sure, and I apologize that I was unable to attend the RTC meeting, as was neither were staff for Longmont, so we weren't there to be able to answer the questions about the project scope. So I would propose a way to move forward so that this project, this increase in bus service in Longmont, which is woefully underserved and where there's huge demand for services, in order that this project not be delayed until August, which would be the ramifications, that we move forward with conditionally approving this tonight, contingent upon a staff finding that the new proposed scope would have a comparable score to the initial proposal, and that RTC moves forward with approval as well. And I could go into the details of why I think that the new scope is very comparable, the needs assessment that was just done on the need for evening and weekend service, bus service in Longmont, but I could also keep it simple and just suggest that we move forward with a conditional approval tonight.
And do you want to make that as a motion for right now? And
sure.
If we get a second, we can have discussion?
Second.
Okay,
sure.
Now we're going to have discussion, and Mr. Van Meter.
Thank you, Chair. In response to the RTC's inaction yesterday, the RTD Board of Directors specifically pulled this service change, service improvement, the Route 324, from their action agenda at their board meeting last night. I've not had a chance to discuss this with any board members at RTD or my boss at this point. But I just wanted to let you know that action has been taken. Typically, our board needs to approve service changes, say, for example, the April ones, this month, in order for that to go into effect. Our board does not have another regularly scheduled meeting till next month, which might be too late to accomplish an April change. I'm speculating. If others have had discussions with my boss, board members, to the contrary, I apologize. I'm a little off guard here, but I just want to relate the facts as they happened last night and as it generally works at RTD for service changes. So I'll be quiet.
Well, I just had a question for you, Bill. It's my understanding there's a study session on the 26th. Is there any chance that the board could address this then?
Instead of speculating on this, I actually think we can take action and move this forward and ask the DRCOG staff to work with the RTD staff to facilitate getting approval, because as you indicated, you are speculating. What RTD board does is not going to impact the decisions we can make tonight. So thank you for making us aware of that concern, and hopefully we can work to address it. So I still think we can move forward with the motion. Yes, Councilmember Peck.
Just for my own edification, can you tell me why the RTC did not approve it? I've had 3 or 4 different answers.
There was a question that was raised regarding whether or not the project was going to achieve the same outcomes with the scope change, and there was effort made to contact staff to find out the answer. We could not get an answer prior to the end of the board of the RTC meeting. Therefore, we didn't want to wait on the other ones, and we were also told that waiting would not impact the project. So we thought it was better safe than sorry. It was just pulled because we thought we could act on it at the February meeting without creating any delays, and that was what the DRCOG staff was told, and that was the only reason.
Okay.
Thank you, and again, apologies to Longmont for the problem this created. But Mayor Atchison.
Thank you. Just a part of the discussion we were having with this, because this has to go back to RTC again, and we've discussed this earlier. We're going to ask that the RTC have an emergency meeting to get this back on. So, Bill, if that in any way helps the process, we know this is an impact. We were not aware it was an impact a week ago. We're trying to deal with that as much as we can. If there's any reason that any of us from the executive board or the chair, either one, should contact anybody at RTD, Chuck or anybody else, let us know to try to help that along. But we do want to get this back on track and not affect Longmont or RTD 1.
Commissioner Partridge.
Madam Chair, is it necessary to have RTD approve this before we can act on it?
No, it is not.
Okay, great.
So we can act this evening. Seeing no other questions or comments, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
I
wanted to ask a question on the motion.
Oh.
What I heard from the commissioner is that it should be made contingent upon a comparable scoring.
Yes.
And I just wanted to make sure that was part of the motion.
It was. Okay. It was my understanding. Is that? Thank you for that clarification. We had a motion and a second. I'm going to ask for the vote again. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained. Okay. And we are going to do our darndest to make sure this gets back on track. Moving on. Thank you very much. I think we've got that one out of the way. Now we are going to be looking at the discussion of actions proposed by DRCOG staff regarding implementation delays of transportation improvement program projects. Mr. Cottrell.
Thank you. So at the end of fiscal year 15, last October, DRCOG asked CDOT and RTD staff to review the project phase status of those projects that had FY15 funding. After confirmation from their staff on each project status, our staff contacted sponsors with project phases that were not initiated to ask, one, find out the reason for that delay, and two, assist them to develop an action plan going forward to initiate that project phase that was delayed. The attached project delays report summarizes the project phases that were not initiated as of September 30th of 2015. The report concludes that 3 project phases are now second year delayed. Those sponsored appear before this board last October to seek a variance to continue within the TIP policy. All 3 were granted a 120-day extension. And 14 project phases are first year delayed, in which through your action this evening would approve them to continue. There is one correction that I would like to note within project number 3. This date should be January 20th, which is today, and that was wrongly entered due to a miscommunication between staff. Be happy to take any comments or questions.
Questions? No questions. I will look for a motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Mr. Cottrell. Now we're moving on to action agenda item number 13. We're way ahead. Discussion of Metrovision outcomes as recommended by the Metrovision Issues Committee. It's attachment J in our packet. Mr. Brad Calvert.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Executive Director mentioned in her report this particular handout that's actually at each of your places. I'll recommend you use this minute to find it, because I'm going to kind of use this as a way to kind of orient many of the new faces to 4 years of work in about 5 minutes. So here, this is your fire hose moment for the evening. I'll hit a few highlights that's covered in the memo as well in terms of this item. This item is attachment J in your packet. The memo starts, I believe, on page 67 of the electronic PDF. As noted in the memo, the last time the board took action on Metrovision, our region's long-range plan, was in February of 2011. That plan is known as Metrovision 2035. It looks something like this, if you've come across it at some point in time. Dr. Cog has actually been doing long-range planning like this since we were created. So for over 60 years, we've been the place that as a region, we sort of think of what our shared values are and ultimately put those values on paper. For the past 20 years, that really has been through something that we've called Metrovision. Knowing how much turnover that we've had, there are probably only a few board members that were present or on the board at the time we actually adopted the plan back in February of 2011, and even fewer that really were part of that dialogue. That update really focused on introducing kind of measurable goals and targets to the plan, which was a really big step for the plan, but in many ways a very small amendment compared to what we're asking the board to consider really beginning this evening. So again, I'll kind of use this graphic to, again, try to collapse 4 years of work into 5 minutes or so, just so that everybody has a sense of, as Jennifer mentioned, kind of where we've been, where we are tonight, and where we're headed in the future. I'll work kind of left to right on the graphic just to kind of give you a bit of a timeline. February 2011, not on the timeline, but that's when the board adopts Metrovision 2035. Just a few short months later, in May of 2011, the board actually adopts a framework that really provides initial direction to staff about what this update should look like. It really outlined an ambitious, inclusive, and collaborative effort to create a revised Metrovision plan rooted in the shared values of Metrovision 2035, but also knowing that we need to explore new issues as well. In April of 2012, we initiated something we called a listening tour. It was an outreach effort specifically designated to identify key issues, initiate our overall stakeholder engagement efforts, and to help inform the overall scope of the activities associated with the planning process. Another item, not on the timeline, given the space, is that one of the reasons we did the listening tour is that we actually had a board workshop back in 2012 where the board really instructed staff that they wanted a very robust public involvement effort associated with this plan, and we should reach out to as many stakeholders as possible and to not only inform them, but to collaborate with them on the development of the plan. So some very quick things on listening tour. More than 200 participants were involved in either interviews or focus groups, online survey with 1,200 or so responses. Going forward to early 2013, the board directed staff to form two new committees to really work directly with staff to create the draft plan that's been available for quite some time. The Metrovision Planning Advisory Committee began meeting in January of 2013. And the Metrovision Citizens Advisory Committee began meeting in April of 2013. The best we know from our institutional knowledge is the first Citizens Advisory Committee that we'd had at Dr. Cog in 30-some-odd years to really get involved directly with planning efforts. Both committees were temporary. They both sunsetted and had their last meeting in December of 2014, but were very integral in ultimately working forward to create a draft for your consideration. One of the things that the board asked the Metrovision Planning Advisory Committee to actually take on is that next item on the timeline, which was scenario analysis. You directed staff to use the Metrovision Planning Advisory Committee as well as the Transportation Advisory Committee to really work with staff to help think about some what-if scenarios about what this region might look like if we had changes to factors. So a couple of things that we looked at during that, we We looked at a scenario that increased the number of lane miles, managed lanes by 200 additional lane miles, 200 additional lane miles of arterials on top of the existing future network. The scenario process looked at what would happen if we really increased the attractiveness of bicycling and pedestrian and walking as a means of travel. We looked at what would happen if you really did focus population and employment in the region's designated urban centers, among other things. So quite a bit of time and effort went into doing that scenario analysis work. Fast forward now, you know, a year or so to September of 2014, we actually had two ad hoc committees of board members that were formed to talk about two very specific and new issues that were being considered as part of the plan development process. One is the issue of housing, and the other is issue of economic vitality, which had not previously been directly integrated into the Metro Vision plan. I believe we had 18 board members involved in the housing group, which met four times between December 2014, I mean between September 2014 and December of that year, and I believe we had 11 board members on the Economic Vitality Ad Hoc Group, which met seven times between September and February of this year. Both groups really had the same charge. They were asked to review data and information that had been developed during kind of the plan analysis phase and to assess the merit of including these topics in the draft Metro Vision plan that obviously the full board will take up. Once we had that input, really the kind of the Economic Vitality Group's input was sort of the last piece of the puzzle to complete a final draft version of the Metro Vision 2040 plan, which was unveiled at the board workshop this year and later in March sent out to all the board members, and has been on the website ever since. So that's kind of gets you really to where we are today, with one huge giant caveat, is that really since that April timeframe, MVIC has been talking about this plan nonstop every month, oftentimes for 2 hours at a time. So MVIC has been spending a lot of time on that, and it's really kind of what you're being asked to think about this evening. As noted in the agenda memo, really Dr. Cog's strategic planning model was sort of this at the center of MVIC's review of the draft plan, and really is central to really the recommendation that MVIC made that you're considering this evening. You can see the strategic planning model, which you've actually heard about back in July, as attachment one. It looks like this, also known as the Green Pyramid. But this has been really sort of central to making sure we are thinking strategically about what our plan seeks to accomplish in terms of what it means to this organization, but also to the region at large. So want to go into sort of this centerpiece. A big part of this has already been done. We're fortunate that the board has adopted a new mission and vision statement, so now we are kind of to the next level down, which are really these themes and outcomes. As the memo states, these overarching themes and outcomes are really kind of areas of focus that must be achieved to accomplish the vision and fulfill the mission of the organization. Right? They are really central. They're the essence of really what Metro Vision is trying to accomplish. Over the coming months, we will continue to bring items to you as they are sort of bundled and ready for the full board's consideration, including objectives and measures. So attachment two is really the item that we're seeking board approval on this evening. It includes MVIC's recommendations on Metro Vision outcomes oriented by overarching theme. It also includes narratives as designed by MVIC to sort of be paired with those outcomes, and also some key definitions. As MVIC was having this conversation, they thought it very important to kind of make sure everyone was on the same page in terms of when people were using terms or terms appeared on paper, that everyone had a shared understanding of what was really being referred to. Another sort of note on something that's included in your packet, attachment three, is something that was actually requested at the February board workshop, and then sort of more formally requested by the board in March, and it kind of just walks you through 5 months of MVIC discussions on this item, so you have a sense as to what ground the committee covered. We made it as high level as we could while still sort of hitting the high points. You can imagine what a summary of 5 months of discussions of 2 hours would look like, so we've done our best for you to just have at least a little bit of a roadmap to kind of understand how you get to the recommendation that's before you this evening. So quickly, to kind of just wrap up this graphic, and then we can turn back to attachment two. We are really obviously working towards board approval of the Metro Vision plan. There's an intervening step that's not here that I think it's important for you to understand, and that's one of the next actions we will ask for the board when we get through your sort of first initial review is to actually release a public review draft so that you can ultimately, when you go to your adoption action, you can hear from the public on their thoughts about the plan that you're ultimately putting forward. After adoption, we will be thinking about sort of an overall communication strategy. How do we actually connect people to the plan, both via the web as well as print? And then obviously we are very interested in implementation, right? We don't want this to be a plan that simply just sits on the shelf. So there are a lot of regional actions and local actions that are currently called for in the draft. And at the same time, we plan to be very vigilant about measuring progress toward achieving the plan outcomes, objectives, and targets in the draft plan, and refining that plan as needed. So that's kind of, again, 4 years worth of work and sort of a preview of what's coming very quickly. So turning back to attachment two quickly, I don't want to walk you through every single recommendation or change that NVIC made to the draft. For those of you that are on NVIC and have participated, you understand that you looked at every single word. And every single word that is going to the board this evening is something that NVIC is ultimately recommending. But there are two things I wanted to quickly touch on, two outcomes that were present in the draft document that NVIC actually recommended to remove from the draft. There was previously an outcome called outcome four, and you'll see in the numbering, I skip over them so that people aren't confused as to what used to be four versus what's four now. And that really was related to the issues of freestanding communities and rural town centers. NVIC is also not recommending outcome seven that was found in the March draft. Outcome seven was one of three transportation-related outcomes in the theme of a connected and multimodal region. As drafted and presented to NVIC in the, sort of the course of the conversation, that outcome was really focused on, you know, making connections between transportation planning, infrastructure, and other quality of life issues. Early in the conversation with NVIC, a few members noted that it felt like that item was covered in other places. So in September, they said, let's just put this on hold. Let's talk about everything else and the draft set of outcomes, and let's revisit this when we've talked about everything else. So in December, NVIC did revisit that and just realized that really they felt comfortable that the objectives associated with Outcome 7 were largely handled other places, and so therefore they are recommending removal of that outcome. One important note for both of those is that even though NVIC did recommend removing each of those outcomes from what you're being presented with tonight, they further indicated very clearly that does not mean the things that fall under those outcomes in terms of objectives, strategies, initiatives, go away. They will revisit those things when the time comes that they get to that point in the conversation. So those will be sort of on the next set of things that they talk about. So this largely concludes my sort of not so brief orientation. I'll turn it over to the chair. Happy to answer questions, provide clarifications, anything else I can do to help with the discussion.
Before I call on you, I'm going to actually ask, do we have a graphic that shows all of the outcomes listed on one sheet? And could you see if somebody could pull that up so the board does? I think it would be important to just at least see a visual of everything together that is being recommended instead of all the packets. So if you have one, can you get one?
I do not have one. Okay. It really is attachment two, and what it's laid out sort of outcome by outcome, and it includes both the outcome statement, the narrative, and the definitions for each.
Okay. Mr. Cernanek.
Yes, Brad, I'm going to embellish a little bit of what you described as the process, because I'd like to make a few points, particularly since we have some new members around the table that are being asked to do this. One is a recognition that the Metro Vision Plan is developed as the underneath the third hat of what DRCOG represents. One is we are an MPO that deals with transportation funding grants. Two, we're the Area Agency on Aging, and third is the Regional Planning Organization, and this is the third hat activity of DRCOG. Secondly, I wanted to mention it's not only stakeholders that there was outreach to and with, but also partners as we eventually are looking at implementation of this, that the economic development groups and other folks that are dealing with issues around housing are also it's not just stakeholders that, but they're folks that would be partners in the regional implementation, and that the outreach effort didn't stop. Our ad hoc board committees actually included input from some of those partners as we look to develop those segments of the plan. So I think I'm accurate on that, and you can just
100%.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? You know, I'm going to ask you guys to indulge me. This is a big document, and I don't want to just pass this, particularly when we've got people who have not seen it. And I am going to ask that we quickly go through these outcomes, because this is providing the framework for where we go next and where we go through 2040. And of any of the work that you're going to be doing down at this table, this is the meat and the beginning of it. So let's start with outcome number one, guys. And again, I'm just going to read them, but I do want this body to be very clear about what we're going to be. This is, as I said, the foundation for where we're going next. So it'll be quick, but the first recommended outcome is the region is comprised of diverse livable communities. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Says the where's the new member from? All right. Recommended outcome number two, new urban development occurs within the contiguous and designated areas identified in the urban growth boundary / area. Yes.
What's the urban growth area?
Well, actually, you know what? I'm not, Brad, I'm going to let you answer this question.
That's a very good question, and something that I will say INVIC spent quite a bit of time talking about. So for those that don't know, Dr. Cog has had something called an urban growth boundary area program since the very first Metro Vision plan. And really, at its essence, what it involves is each community in the region commits to allocating their future urban growth to a particular part of their community, and ultimately notifies Dr. Cog and your peers as to where that growth is going to occur. So it's an ever evolving and changing map. I've had conversations with at least two jurisdictions in the last month that are looking to do sort of self-certified changes. So right now, we have something on the order of magnitude of about 950 square miles of future urban growth that's anticipated for the year 2035. One of the very first things that this board will do after the plan is adopted is to have a refresh of the conversation of urban growth boundary area to ask communities, do you need additional allocation beyond what you're currently allocated?
And I will also note there is a definition there is not a map, but there is a definition. And the Dr. Cog staff, for any of the new board members, actually conducted a series of mini workshops that were offered to the board in the fall to discuss the issues associated with urban growth boundaries. It may make sense to offer another one of those, but at a minimum, if you would like to see the slides that were presented, please make a request to the Dr. Cog staff. And Connie, if you could send it to Connie Garcia at the Dr. Cog, we can at least get those presentation materials out to you in the short term. But very good question. any others on the recommended outcome two? All right. And please stop me if there are questions as we move forward. Recommended outcome three, it's connected urban centers and multimodal corridors accommodate a growing share of the region's housing and employment. The regional transportation system is well connected and serves all modes of travel. The transportation system is safe, reliable, and well maintained. Outcome six. Outcome eight, the region has clean water and air and lower greenhouse gas emissions. Nine, the region values, protects, and connects people to its diverse natural resource areas, open space, parks, and trails. And 10, the region's working agricultural lands and activities contribute to a strong regional food system. Good question. Yes, Mayor Christman. Oh,
Are we promoting greenhouse marijuana use, or are we silent on it?
I would argue we, with greenhouse use, is this is working agricultural lands, so.
That's.
But I would also, you know, this
an
this
agricultural crop.
Right, and I think it can be interpreted, and this is the broad outcome. I think under the objectives, we will get specific about what we achieve or what we're trying to achieve. But I don't know if anybody else that was participating in MVIC would care to comment on this. That was not anything that was raised, nor, in my opinion, considered when we were discussing working agricultural lands. But, Shakti.
Well, just that it talks about a food system, so that seems
well,
like a narrow
herb. And you can consume it,
but it's not considered food.
But it's not nutrition.
Well, I think we have our first question that we will be discussing under the objectives.
Okay. I'm just asking.
Right. No, I don't think it was raised during the MVIC discussion. So I think staff is taking note of that, and it will be something that will be brought up to this body. Are there any other? Yes.
Marijuana is not a crop.
And the debate begins. No. Yep. Okay. All right. Well, we will be discussing it. I think that point has been cleared this evening. And the good thing is we don't have to decide these things tonight, but it will be a discussion under the umbrella of this. So moving on, if I don't see any other questions or comments, recommended outcome 11, the risk and effects of natural and human-created hazards is reduced. Recommended outcome 12, the built and natural environment supports healthy and active choices. The recommended outcome 13, the region's residents have expanded connections to health services. 14, diverse housing options meet the needs of residents of all ages, incomes, and abilities. 15, all residents have access to a range of transportation, employment, commerce, housing, educational, cultural, and recreational opportunities. And the last, investments in infrastructure and amenities allow people and businesses to thrive and prosper. So there you have it, folks, the outcome for the 2040 Metro Vision. Are there any comments, additional comments on those? Commissioner.
Well, I just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge the incredible number of hours and hard work that MVIC put into getting to this point, and particularly for the new members that maybe they're at their first or second meeting. We're almost a year behind in our adoption of this because we have spent so much time going over these and wordsmithing and really wrestling with what are the important outcomes. And it's nice to hear them all read through and go, hey, we did pretty good work. And obviously there's a lot more work to be done on the back end to really get specific about the objectives. So we have some more hours in front of us. But I just wanted to take a moment to congratulate MVIC on the good work. And I'm happy to put a motion on the table whenever you're ready.
I think we're ready.
So I would, yes.
So just the question would be, once it's adopted, once it's put into place and it's out on the web, so that then what happens? Then how do we take it back to our communities and actually implement this? And can you explain that?
Sure.
Like, I get, you know, that we're approving it and it's a great work and I'd like to see more of it. That would be interesting to see the whole thing. But I'd like to know what happens next or 5 years down the road.
Sure. So just to be clear, we're very, very early kind of even in the sort of review approval phase. So this is kind of an initial thing just to make sure that you guys are comfortable with what will ultimately be in a public review draft. One of the things that even MVIC really hasn't maybe spent a lot of time on right now is something in the plan that's really focused on regional and local actions. So what, to your point, what can the region do? What can communities around this table? What can we all individually and collectively work on to ultimately make sure that the outcomes that you guys just talked about are achieved, right? So, you know, we orient much of our work program to making sure that Metro Vision is something that can be achieved. So, for instance, just one example is, you know, we host trainings and workshops on issues related to things that are important in Metro Vision probably four or five times a year so that local staff can come in and learn about issues and recognize maybe there are things that they can take home to their community that will that ultimately will work and that also contribute in some way to the achievement of the shared regional vision. So it's very much oriented, we orient our work program to making sure that our communities, stakeholders, like Phil mentioned, really have access to understanding how they we can all collectively work towards this shared vision.
And Councilmember Daigle, I also want to comment that this is a regional vision and it isn't ever anticipated that any one community and is utopia and that one, as much as I'd like to think Lone Tree is, we're probably not going to be able as an individual community to achieve all of this, and this is a collective vision. And Dr. Cog is not going to be responsible for achieving this vision independently as well. It's something we'll be working with our partners, local government, nonprofits, and citizens and business community to achieve this. But this is the start and from where we're going to build. Yes.
This might be a little early, but I'm just curious of what the evaluation process is going to be like and how do we determine if we're meeting these goals that, you know, that you just listed off.
Do you want to go?
Yeah. So one of the things I'll give you a preview of a conversation that INVIC had already, but the board will take up in the coming months, is there is a very real element of the plan, the draft plan, that's about performance measurement and management. The draft plan that's out there on the web right now and that was sent to the board previously has, I believe, 75 measures that we're committing to track over time related to these outcomes and to the related objectives, just to again, track how are we doing, right? So that one of the key words in the sort of very far right-hand side of that graphic is the word refinement. Like let's over time understand where we are, what progress we're making, and do we actually need to change our approach, or do we just need to sort of double down maybe on an approach that we already think is working? So that's something that we expect, you know, most likely annually to share with the board quite a bit of measurement so that you can understand how we're doing on the things that you've established as being really important to the region.
And I want to point out, actually, I think this graphic does a nice job of kind of where we are. We're right now in the themes and outcomes area. The next thing we're going to be, and this is what the work that the board is going to be doing, is identifying the objectives. We are certainly going to use the draft document as a starting point. But then we're going to be identifying the measures. So we will be determining as a body how we are going to be defining success. And I think that is the very important work that is going to be undertaken by this body over the course of the next year. So we really need you engaged and educated and as up to speed on this as you can be. Mr. Shenanigans.
I'm going to ask the commissioner's indulgence, since I was on MVIC back in 2011 and having been at the inception of this, could I make the motion? So I move to approve the Metro Vision 2040 plan drafts, overarching themes and outcomes.
Is there any other discussion? This is all for your last meeting, Commissioner Partridge.
Douglas County, we'd just like to go on the record. There are a few of the, I forget what we call them, our outcomes that we disagree with, but to keep the process moving forward, we do support the motion. But I would see if we might amend the motion to suggest a numbering system go to 1 to 14 instead of leaving out numbers 4 and 7.
Accepted.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any other comments? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Okay, this is the beginning, folks. I'm looking forward to the end. So congratulations. At this point, we had an oversight, a little bit of a communication glitch between some of us up here. And I'm going to ask if we could move back to the delayed projects attachment I. I was remiss in not recognizing Mayor Rakowski. Who has a comment on the project that was in Greenwood Village.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In October, I appreciated the support of the board for the extension. I made a promise. I failed. Let me read the letter which was submitted yesterday to Ms. Schaufel. Unfortunately, the City of Greenwood Village must, in the interest of good government, canceled the subject project at this time. There are several reasons for the cancellation. First, very recently there has been unforeseen significant development interest within the area surrounding the project. Development interest created an atmosphere in which the acquisition of property, which is right away, was extremely difficult. Second, while we strongly committed to providing a multimodal transportation system, the area is now under consideration by the City Council to change the comprehensive plan to increase the vitality of the Orchard Light Rail Station. Lastly, to expend this amount of money, given the reasons stated above, would be an arbitrary and capricious waste of taxpayer dollars. I am confident that, again, for the reasons stated above, these funds will be better used elsewhere in the DRCOG region. The City of Greenwood Village deeply appreciates the selection of the project, and we look forward to creating and constructing meaningful future projects. Respectfully, thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you for your good stewardship of our dollars. So, with that, do we need to go back and amend the motion? Or we're okay. All right, wonderful. Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Graves.
Madam Chair, just one quick footnote on this Metro Vision discussion. Really just wanted to commend the staff on this graphic. This is an excellent executive level summary of a very complex issue, and I think we can continue to use more tools like this in the future because it's a great kind of rapid summary. Thank you.
Thank you. And hope staff, thank you for your good work as always. Okay, moving on to in our agenda, we're now going to discuss the other 230-something bills, right? So the DRCOG staff is overworked.
Let's hope not.
We're on agenda item number 14, discussion of state legislative issues. Mr. Rich Morrow, this is the most rested he's going to look for the next few months till July, so please.
Actually, I've already been losing some sleep.
I know.
And Madam Chair, I might want to borrow that. What was it you said about the Metro Vision? You were excited to get it started, but you can't wait for the end, or
looking forward to it.
I feel like that about the legislative session. So
I'll feel that way about this.
Yeah. And as Jennifer indicated in her earlier comments, we've had to send out a couple of different emails to you guys and put. So you might have two different status sheets on there for you. So hopefully it's not going to get too confusing, but if it does, stop me and we'll straighten things out. But what we have here then, the first one I'm looking at is titled New Bills 2016 Session as of 1/15/16.
That's the stapled version that we have at our...
That was sent out on Friday, and then of course we had a few more bills introduced after that went out, and then there was a holiday, a weekend and a holiday, and so we sent out the three additional bills on the additional new bills sheet yesterday. And I'll also mention typically what you've done with this in the past is if you agree with the staff recommended positions, we could treat it as like a consent agenda and just get a motion. If you have a question or concern about any of the bills or the staff position recommendation, we can pull that off and discuss it separately. There are two of them that we will have to pull off anyway or discuss separately because I'm asking for your direction on them. But unless there's any additional questions at this point, I'll just move right in.
I think we should start.
Okay. So quickly, House Bill 1065 is a bill, a different version of a bill that was introduced last session that we also monitored. It's intended to help seniors or older adults afford being able to live in their home to, you know, get some home modifications or other things that would help them, but as a tax credit, I'm guessing that it's probably got a long road at the Capitol given the budget scenario, and we monitored the bill last year, and I'm asking for now to do that again this year.
Do you want comments as we go, Rich?
Sure, we can do comments as we go.
And evidently you have one, so the chair will acknowledge you.
Thank you. This one was discussed at the Advisory Committee on Aging on Friday as well, and Director Sanchez Warren indicated that it's unlikely that this would, as it's structured right now, will achieve the objective of helping those that would have need to actually be able to take advantage of the tax credit, because they would first have to outlay the cost for repairs, which are generally in the thousands of dollars, and then wait for a tax refund
back.
And yet they would be somewhere south of a $45,000 income level. And
anyway, right.
Anyway, monitor is probably appropriate, but recognize that I think maybe the director or others can help folks question whether this is going to achieve the intention of what where the real need is.
And we're happy to convey that message to the sponsor.
Mr. Morrow, if I might ask you to, for the benefit of the new board members, to explain what it means when we actively oppose something, you know, the level of effort required from the staff for support, monitor, and, and just so people understand.
And one thing we, let me say, one thing we haven't done in the past is has gone into, you know, multiple gradations of support, strongly support, oppose, strongly support. We've just had support, oppose, and monitor. And then we've identified those bills that we're supporting or opposing that we're going to really spend a lot of time on and lobby hard. And so I can make sure that I'm cognizant of that when I'm talking about a bill, that this is one we're really spending a lot of time on.
Thank you. Do you want to take action on these individually? Do you want?
We can do that if you want, if you prefer.
Okay. I think we are going to be talking about some. So the staff position is to monitor. Can I have a motion? Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Aye. Okay. Thank you.
Just one discussion piece on this particular one is it's expected that the fiscal note will probably cause this one to die anyway.
Yeah, and that's really what I'm waiting for. The next one is the 1008, the roadway shoulder access for buses. It's primarily of interest up on North US 36, and suggesting that you support this.
Are there any comments? Mayor Atchison.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just from the standpoint of this moving forward, we did bring this from the US 36 MCC. Commissioner Jones and myself are two of the members of that board.
Can you speak into it? We're having a little trouble hearing.
Then we've been working with the sponsor, Representative Winter, and has joined right now. We have bipartisan support, both houses, House and the Senate, moving this forward. The big part of this was brought on because of the state law that prevented buses from being on the shoulder without CSP ticketing them. And we've been working, in fact, we just met this past week with HPTE, CDOT, to talk about the issues of how they're going to maintain those roadway shoulders and deal with the inadvertent parked car on a shoulder. So those are some of the things that are being looked at as part of the bill. We will be testifying on behalf of the 36th group next Tuesday, I believe is now the date. It could be Thursday. I'm still waiting final confirmation, but I think we've all looked very hard that this is something that we've got to fix when we have these traffic congestions, and there are some very stringent rules around when RTD can arrive on the shoulder, the speed limits, and what actions they have. And if anybody's ever interested, there's a very good training video that we were able to see last week on how the bus drivers are trained and how they have to react to these things. So that's available to DRCOG or any members that wants it. But I believe that we're trying to fix a problem that was missed, and we're trying to move that forward. So at least from the US 36 coalition, that includes every community along US 36, we'll get full support for this legislature there.
Mayor Jones, did you have a comment? Okay. Mayor Pro Tem Pfeiffer.
So in those discussions as a coalition, I mean, one big problem ICCDOT doesn't do is clean the shoulders. So from debris and all sorts of stuff being kicked up with these massive buses, I mean, is CDOT to keeping those shoulders clean?
They're, even down to HPTE has given us a breakdown of the priority of how they clean lanes. from the inner managed lane piece all the way out. The initial pass, as an example, during snow plowing, they'll move from the managed lanes to the free lanes. Thing goes on the shoulder. When they get back, then they'll start clearing the shoulders. But there's still the issue of enforcement of how they get the cleanup, and that will be primarily, the cleanup will be HPTE, or I'm sorry, in this case of 36, will be plenary roads. They'll have to keep that off. Part of the legislation is going to fix the issue of what CSP does right now. If a car breaks down, they can't ticket it for the first 48 hours. Those are some of the things that they're trying to deal with this legislation and how they get those cars off the road.
Yeah, I just want to stress the sweepers. I mean, if any of us drive on 25, 76, whatever.
Oh, there's an occasional tire, a fender, motor.
Or, you know, 5 years of gravel sitting there that they'd never swept up.
Yeah,
just because I think you're going to cause other problems. I just want to stress that importance if we want to be effective in that corridor.
And I think these are important issues. I just want to keep note of the time tonight. So yes, we still have a few things ahead of us.
I would like to make a motion that we support this bill.
Is there any other discussion on this issue? Councilmember Peck and then Ms. Perkins-Smith.
Thank you. When I was reading this, it says that, where was it? vehicles designed for 16 passengers or more that are a government entity or a government-owned business. Are we talking about shuttles, airport shuttles, vans as well, or is this just specifically for buses? Because the wording to me is a little bit...
It's planned specifically for buses. It's only to be used when their traffic does not move at a certain rate to allow the RTD buses to meet their delivery requirements on time.
Okay.
So it's a very small window that they get to use it, and they're very restricted on... They can only go 35 miles an hour at max over and above the speed of ongoing traffic.
Okay, so it's not by a contractor on behalf of such an entity?
Yes.
Or a government-owned business. It's
no,
not
this
any
is strictly
other,
to allow RPD totally buses to go on the shoulder. Nobody else.
Okay.
Ms. Perkins-Smith.
So I believe this is not just specific to US 36, although that's how the issue was raised. It would give us some flexibility in the future to do that in other locations where it is also needed. So I just wanted to make that
point. Thank you for that clarification.
So it might benefit everybody.
Thank you. Okay. Any other discussion?
Just one. If this passes, I would like to also be able to, when we go down to testify, if that's acceptable for the board, to note that we have taken a position as Dr. Cog in support of this. If this motion passes,
absolutely.
If there are no objections from the members.
That would always be our privilege.
Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Abstained. You can say unanimously supported now.
Good.
All right. Moving on.
Thank you. Thank you. The next two... our TLRC bills, one of which Jennifer already touched on. I'll explain them briefly, and then I might ask if Ms. Perkins-Smith might have something to say from CDOT's perspective on this, too. I've had conversations with CDOT's lobbyists about these as well. The first one deals with procedures of the STAC, the Transportation Advisory Committee. I believe the difference is just clarifying that the STAC can have communications directly with the Transportation Commission, not just with CDOT and CDOT staff. And everyone I've talked to has kind of said, that's fine, you know, we can support that. And the second one, 1031, is the one that Ed and Jen talked about with Representative Carver. And they did a really good job last summer talking her into a study. But I'm asking your discretion, partly because she's actually approached Ed and Jen several times since the session began, asking, what's Dr. Cog think about this? Is there anything I need to do to change it, to make you guys happy? And I think she'd like us to support it, but that doesn't mean we have to. But I think it could be an interesting study that the TLRC would do next summer based on this bill. Deborah, did you have anything to add?
Sure. Let me just add a couple of thoughts here. CDOT has not taken a position yet on either of these bills, but I can share with you a little bit of the conversation. On the STAC, the Transportation Advisory Committee,
That is in law currently, and currently they do advise CDOT. So they advise CDOT, not the commission. So this bill would be to actually add that they can, they're also advising the commission. I don't think we have an issue with that. We haven't taken a position. In terms of modifying the Transportation Commission, I noticed your notes that it means that for the DRCOG region, you actually have three representatives. Just so you know, if they went to one representative for each TPR, that would mean DRCOG has one.
Right.
And today you have three, but I should mention you actually have five. There are pieces of two other commissioners that are actually in the DRCOG region. Okay. Yeah. So that affects five. So that's a big change for DRCOG.
Which is the reason why we talked her out of that initial idea in the first place.
Right. So I just wanted to tell you it was more than three. The other thing is discussions at CDOT are that we have from time to time actually taken a look at the districting and the number of commissioners, and that has changed over time. And usually that tends to occur with the census. After the census, there's a look at this, and there hasn't been. So with the last census, so it's about time. So that's some of the discussion we've had, but we have not taken a position on the bill.
Sure. And I would add, and I think it's referenced in the summary, that the bill lays out a number of different criteria or data points or whatever you want to call them that could be taken into consideration in redrawing districts. And I think Ed told me that Representative Carver has indicated to him, you know, she's mostly concerned with like some rural districts that have complained that they've got multiple different regions or commissioner districts in there overlapping with their TPRs and multiple TPRs and so forth, and there's some interest on other areas of the state to seeing if there's ways to streamline that or whatever. So it wouldn't just be the one thing.
Mayor Rakowski, and then Mayor Atchison.
I would remind the group that we have once a year a joint Transportation Commission DRCOG meeting. The most recent one, which I attended, the subject came up from two different commissioners from two different parts of the state. In so many words, they didn't believe it was broken. Why does it need to be fixed? And two, I think it would expand the government and make it more complicated and more expensive. So were I voting as an individual, I would strongly oppose this bill.
Mayor Atchison?
Kind of in along with Ron's comment is, and Deborah, I refer it back to you because we spent quite a bit of time at the dinner that Ron talked about talking to the other commissioners and CDOT director, and it was pretty evident from the conversations we had that night that I didn't find one commissioner in the room that was there that night, which was at their annual meeting here in Denver, that supported this. In fact, every one of them was very opposed to changing the alignment.
Amen.
So if I could comment, at that point it was not proposed as a study.
Right.
At that point it was proposed a one-for-one, so 15 commissioners, and I think some of the discussion that night was that, gosh, there are 11 now, and you know, it's hard to work with, not hard to work with 11, but you've got 11, you know, if you up that to 15, it makes it even more difficult in terms of coordination. The other thing is, for the Transportation Commission, they do not represent specifically their district. They are from that district, but they have a statewide perspective. Hence one of the reasons you've got numerous commissioners actually taking a little part of the Denver metro area. So I think the way the bill was proposed at that time, each TPR had a representative, and there was some concern that there'd be balkanization rather than looking at the state as a whole in terms of transportation. So that was some of their concerns, I think, that night. But since then, it has now changed to a study. And I think that's a little bit different, taking a look at VMT, you know, population, rather than just saying, okay, each TPR gets a representative.
Commissioner Jones?
Agree.
So I totally agree with the mayor's recollection of our meeting with the TC and how there wasn't a any desire to expand the number. When Representative Carver came to the STAC, she already had heard loud and clear that we had issues, and I explained the DRCOG position on. And she quickly she was already in the process of backing off and moving this to a study. I'm not sure that I think we need to make changes, but I don't know that we should be scared to study it. And given that this bill sponsor accommodated us, I think we should at least want to have a seat at this table to look at it. So I guess I'm a little bit agnostic on whether we support or monitor, but I definitely think we want to be a part of the conversation and make sure that DRCOG's interests are represented in the discussion.
Councilmember Quinn.
Thank you, Madam President. Maybe we're looking at it the wrong way. Maybe we should ask that the study include looking at realigning the TPRs to conform to the director districts instead. That might make too much sense.
Yeah.
But it should be, that should also be on the table. Mm-hmm. And I know in the Denver region where we have several commissioner districts, you know, that the TPRs could work together, perhaps, and coordinate. But that might accomplish both goals that Representative Carver is looking at and meet our objections as well, our objectives as well.
Monitor.
Do you make a motion?
Yeah.
Mayor Rakowski? I mean, Mayor Atchison, I apologize.
He looks better than I
do. Do not sit next to each other.
Yeah. Madam Chair, I would move a motion that the board take a position of monitor on this bill at this time until we get better clarification.
Can I just modify that to say actively monitor? Because I think we want to be on the at the table.
And right? Can you just clarify which bill you're referring to in this?
Cause House Bill 1031.
Okay, because we didn't take action on the other one either. So we have a motion to monitor.
Second.
Actively monitor. A motion and a second. House Bill 1031. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay. We could just quickly back up to House Bill 1610-18. What is the pleasure of the board on this one? Staff's recommended position is support.
Move to support.
Second.
All those any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. On the next page, I also asked for your direction on 1039, which is one you've probably, a lot of you probably have heard about, the traction equipment on I-70, mainly up the mountains. Most of the time, board doesn't take positions on bills that are more or less traffic related or like deal with anything that's not really part of the system or funding or those kinds of things. So I wasn't sure if this was a bill that you would want to take a position on, but I know it's been talked about a lot and it has a lot of interest up that corridor. So I thought I'd at least call it to your attention and see whether or not you thought it was something we should take a position on.
Their comments or questions? Commissioner Rozier.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Jefferson County Board of Commissioners actually has a position on this one. We've talked with our lobbyists at the Capitol. We are looking, this impacts Jeffco as far as it goes all the way down I-70 down to Morrison. And we've received some pushback and some concerns for those individual businesses and individuals who live further up mountain, especially up in the Evergreen Conifer area. And so we have asked for a modification to this bill such that it would only extend to State Highway 74. And it would stop right there at that Evergreen exit and would not be enforceable beyond that. Thank you.
Commissioner Hayden.
The Clear Creek County Board of County Commissioners strongly support this for obvious reasons. Anyone that was stuck in a 14-hour traffic parking lot, it was caused from traction on private vehicles.
Are there any other comments? Is there a suggested motion for this bill? Mr. Stanek.
A move to support with the Jefferson County modification.
I will second that.
Okay, motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstained? Do we have two abstentions? Okay.
Madam Chair, quickly for the record, I need to consult with my legislative affairs team on each bill before I can voice a vote, so I'll be abstaining on each vote this evening.
Okay, thank you. And
we have taken a position on this.
Okay, thank you. All right, moving on.
All right, the next bill, I'm asking to just monitor this bill that would require the statewide transportation plan to consider the transportation needs around the military installations, mainly because it just came out and it was the first time I'd seen it, and I haven't had enough time to get real information about it to inform you about it.
All right. Are there any questions, comments, or a motion on this one? Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. And then the next one, 1067. I think you're all aware of the RTA statute, the Regional Transportation Authority statute. There's half a dozen or so of them around the state. And the issue, this one actually came up in TLRC, and I think they declined to make it a TLRC bill by one vote. But the sponsors are bringing, or the who were on the committee are bringing the bill anyway. And basically, it just reauthorizes the mill levy in the RTA statute, which is set to expire in 2019. The other funding sources, like the sales tax in the statute, don't expire, so they don't need that kind of extension. But this bill just would extend that additional funding option for RTAs.
The recommended staff position is support. Mr. Cernanek.
Rich, if you could, and maybe you know this, is this an authorization up to a maximum, and yet for each region they would have to, you know, if they're going to change their mill levy on this, they'd have to go to a local vote?
I believe that's correct.
Additional comments, questions? I would entertain a motion. We have a motion to support. Is there a second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And we, any additional abstentions other than ones previously noted? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. The last one on this sheet is pretty self-explanatory, actually. Dr. Cog, I think, is the board has opposed every bill since 2009 that has tried to cut into the funding sources for in the faster legislation, and this one would do that rather significantly, including specifically removing all the funding for transit, which we've also supported. So I'm recommending that Dr. Cog oppose the bill.
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion to oppose and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And any additional abstentions? Thank you. Moving on to the single sheet.
Yes. House Bill 1027. This is an amendment to the what we often call the mandatory reporting statute that Colorado adopted a few years ago, mandating various professions report sightings or concerns about abuse or neglect of at-risk older adults. I think it defines them as age 70 or older. And this bill comes from district attorneys, and I believe what I've been told is that district attorney Scott Story in Jefferson County has been one of the main proponents going way back of this legislation. They've had some problems in bringing cases to court with difficulties getting testimony from victims and so forth, and there's sort of a precedent with this depositions or video depositions in other adult abuse and child abuse cases, and they want the statute to authorize them to be able to do these remote types of depositions in these cases as well. So we ask for support on that.
Are there any questions? Mayor Atchison.
May I refer to Jayla. How does this fit in with our AAA evaluations of these facilities?
And so for the new board members, Jayla, why don't you just tell them your title as well?
I'm Jayla Sanchez Warren. I'm the director of the Area Agency on Aging here. So I think this is a good thing. There are people in facilities, nursing homes, that have been abused, and they can't go to court.
Right.
So, you know, to do this kind of remote deposition, I think, would be beneficial and allow their voice to be heard.
Yeah. Thank you. Are there any additional questions?
I'm confused. We're getting a recommendation to support from AAA, but on here it says staff direction discretion to oppose.
Oh, no, that's a different bill.
No, we're on 16 dash.
Sorry.
Oh, the opposite side. Yep. Flip that one over.
Opposite side.
We have a motion to support.
Second.
And a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Additional abstentions? Thank you. Okay, we're on.
Senate Bill 57. This is a bill, a slightly different version of a bill Dr. Cog monitored last year, so I'm asking to do that again, at least for now, until I get more details about this. And it's the first one that I've seen so far of probably a significant group of so-called affordable housing bills that we're going to see in the legislature this year. So expect to see me present several others starting next month. And so I just basically want to add this to the list for now, and we'll see.
Mayor Jones.
I was just going to say the issue of trying to maintain mobile home parks as a viable housing option and to equal the scales between the owners of the trailers and the landlords is a big priority for us. So I think this is great that we're going to be actively engaged in this.
Okay.
So can I make a motion?
Yes, you can.
I would make a motion that staff actively monitor this.
Is there a second? Discussion on the motion? Councilmember Peck?
I just have a question on the bill. It says to mediate disputes between or among landlords, management, and homeowners, et cetera. If we mediate, does that take away the homeowner's right to sue?
That's one of the things I'm wanting to research to find that out.
Okay, because I'm against that.
Right.
Thanks.
Okay, there is a motion to actively monitor and a second on the floor. Are there any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Additional abstentions on this one? Okay. We are moving on to the last bill.
Last one. Woohoo. So this is actually also a reoccurrence of a bill that failed to pass last session. You didn't see this. I didn't get a chance to present this to you because it came up as a very late bill, late in the session, after the last board meeting, before the session ended. And we and others had expressed concerns, basically, that this bill, not necessarily with any problem with mandating continuing education credits for administrators of assisted living facilities, which might be part of what Mayor Atchison was getting at.
Right.
But primarily because the health department has a working group right now that's been meeting to revise all of the health department's regulations for assisted living residences. And in the process, that's one of the things they're going to be settling on is these continuation credits and other sort of certification requirements for these administrators. And didn't think it was a good idea to have the legislature step in during that process and preempt them and mandate a certain, what seems to be, at least according to our staff, a somewhat arbitrary 30 credits before this group of stakeholders finishes its work later this year. But similar to a couple of the bills we mentioned already, the bill sponsor, the Senate sponsor, Senator Martinez-Humanic, has approached us on a couple of different occasions about this, hoping that that we can get to a place where we might be able to support something. She says she's willing to work with us on this. We've conveyed that I'm not sure we'll get there, but rather than just coming right out and opposing it at this point, wanted to leave the door open to, again, actively work with the sponsor to see if we can reach some accommodation and report back to you next month.
Commissioner Partridge.
Madam Chair, I wonder if Jayla would come to the mic. I had a question for Jayla. Jayla, I'm wondering, we had a conversation regarding group homes here at the open house. Would this kind of fall into, or do you see this as an open door to address some of those concerns you had regarding group homes?
Well, this definitely needs, training is a big issue in assisted living facilities or group homes, smaller personal care boarding homes. That's a huge issue. In agreement with what Rich said, our staff are participating on these groups at the health department to modify the regulations. This bill is being pushed by owners of assisted living facilities, and I'm not sure they're always the most objective folks to make this decision. And so we'd like the stakeholders group and the health department to work collectively to and go through the process of identifying what needs to be accomplished and what's reasonable.
So do you think there's an option to modify this with the sponsor?
Well, it's one of our former board members, right? And she was on the advisory committee, and I know she's trying to do the best thing. So I think there is an opportunity to modify with her and talk with her a little bit more and kind of tell both sides of the story.
All right. Thank you.
Mayor Crisman.
I would argue the way they have it structured is open to abuse, not abuse of elders, abuse of the system, in that every 22 months the facilitator could go elsewhere. To attaching the requirement to the facility doesn't make any sense. What you should have is a requirement that they have a licensed administrator. Licensing requires these credits, and then you covered both, and they can move between facilities as necessary without doing this. So I would argue that this doesn't achieve what they want to achieve.
Right, I agree.
And that's one of the things we could talk to them about.
Yeah.
Good suggestion.
Mr. Stanek.
And I'll look to the director too, but what I would hate to have happen is that something such as the completion of the credits is allowed to be a presumption of competency and would preclude action that could be as the result of abuse or negligence, so that there's not a diminishment of the liability on that front. And so there's a number of questions on this that I would say they're all due respect to Beth.
It's good. That's good too. Okay.
Are there any other council member data?
I have a question. So my assumption, being a nurse and in the that it would be monitored by DORA. The 30 credits would be monitored by DORA.
Not in this. In this I don't case. Think in this scenario it
would
is.
Probably
but
be
in
the health department.
The health department's case. Scenario is yes, monitored
it would
by DORA.
Monitored by the Department of Regulatory Agencies, and they would be tracking the credits and what have you.
Yeah.
And if in that, then they would also track if there were any kind of misuse of their.
I'm not sure that's specified in here, Rich. No, I don't think it is in this one. That's why we want the health department process to go through.
You guys, one of you speak at a time, please. It's hard for me to follow.
Who's going to go, Rich, you or me? Okay. So in this bill, DORA would not monitor it, but that's why we want the health department process to go through, because then the health department, that recommendation, DORA would be involved and would be monitoring those.
Councilmember Malika.
Just for clarification, Senator Martinez-Humanic came and spoke with North Glen a couple weeks ago, and she did say that CDPHE would be monitoring the education with the way it was.
It's a given. I mean, if it's the health department, it would be, because assisted livings are already monitored through the health department. And the only reason I know this is I'm working on my master's in order to do this.
Right.
So in order to get that position as an administrator of an assisted living, you need to go through DORA. It is a Department of Regulatory Agencies. They look at your license. You have a license. You are a licensed individual.
So the difference between this is that they're licensing the facility, not an individual.
The individual.
Right.
Right.
So then the health department would make sense to license the facility. But again, I agree with the concerns that were talked about earlier. It's more about the individual that.
We're still here. I'm home for breakfast.
Okay. Are there any other comments or questions regarding this?
Yes.
Did I hear? Oh, he's on the phone saying yes. I was like, okay, what are they? All right. I will look for, seeing none, I will look for a motion.
Move to support the staff recommendation.
Okay, the staff position is discretion to oppose. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Additional abstentions? Okay, we're concluded with the first round of our legislative session.
And one last comment, Madam Chair.
Yes. Yes.
And since I'm up here, there's an agenda item under informational items. Just wanted to call your attention to it because I know you might be all in a hurry to get out later. I think it's item 18, transmittal of draft of 2016 federal legislative policy. The board may recall you adopted the state policy in December, and so we've included in your packet draft revisions to the federal policy, primarily updating the transportation section to reflect passage of the reauthorization for the, what is it, FAST bill, and some tweaks to the aging section to bring some of that language up to date as well. So I encourage you to look at it, have your staffs look at it. If you have questions or comments or suggested changes, to email them to me, preferably before the meeting if we can, but obviously we can bring them up at the meeting in February, and I'll be back before you for consideration and action in February.
Thank you. And again, I want to echo that attachment, and if you have the opportunity, have your staff review it. I actually received a lot of great comments from my staff, so I think it's worthwhile. All right, moving on to agenda item number 15, discussion of the Statement of Understanding. I'm going to ask you all to turn to Attachment L in your packet. Mr. Jerry Stiegel, director, and here he is, organization
development. Magically appeared.
That's right. And I have a comment after you introduce it.
Oh, good. Good evening, everyone. Jerry Stiegel with staff, director of organizational development. This is, we're coming back on this one last piece of the onboarding program that the board had approved in a prior meeting. And so this action is related to the structure group work on the Statement of Understanding. This document that's in front of you is the last piece of the onboarding program. And structure group, if you'd raise your hands one more time, please, to remind. Thank you. Worked on this document, and it's been brought back for additional discussion. So I'd like to open it up for any or all structure group members to maybe set the stage for the document and allow for some discussion.
Mr. Pfeiffer. Did you get demoted, Mayor Pro Tem Pfeiffer? I'm sorry.
Everyone steps one step back, and I'm forward to bring some of these subjects up. But so the purpose, I think we need to kind of ground what the purpose of this document is really to level set the expectations of members of the board. I think just so there's a clear understanding of expectations, a lot of nonprofits, governance boards, a lot of them can fail for reasons of just not understanding what the expectation of the board member is. And this document's intent, and it's still fluid, so this is what we want to talk about tonight, is to make sure that when we onboard a board member, that they really know what's expected of them when they come to this table. Several folks, you know, we've all been new at some point, and it's been a challenge or a struggle, and maybe expectations were not properly shared from your council or your county. But this is an opportunity to at least get some documentation in front of somebody that say, this is what we would like to see from you. So this is not set in stone. I think this is really open for discussion. I think there's some edits that can happen in here, and we would really like to see this move forward as soon as we can so we can start again with a new structure and everything else with a good approach with onboarding. So I'll be one of several members of this committee that will answer any questions.
Shakti.
I completely agree with all of that, and I think that there was also sort of a sentiment that there's some significance to joining the board and sort of marking that significance and understanding what it means together.
And so before we have more of the board members who participated in the structure governance, I actually think this was introduced at the last board meeting, and I think there was a reaction from some of the board members to it, and I think we should give some of those folks an opportunity to talk about some of the concerns that they did have. And so Laura Chrisman, Mayor Chrisman, and had approached me, so I'm going to actually ask, and has done a lot of work on her that she presented to me earlier last week with some suggested modifications, which will be shared with the Structure and Governance Group. But I think she's going to give us some background on kind of what her thinking was in the revisions.
And first off, I owe Bob an apology. So I'm sorry, Bob.
I haven't seen the edit yet.
Oh, you still haven't seen the edit? Oh, okay.
I forwarded. Yeah,
you forwarded it. Right. Okay. And I worked with Roger on this as well. I serve on a lot of boards, as many of you do. And I will tell you that, in my opinion, keeping things simple and short is the best way to get buy-in to these acknowledgments. And they should reflect and not change or amend any of the policies or anything that you already have out there. If there's something that you want to change in the way the board, a policy, that should be done as a policy and not through an acknowledgment. But there's a couple things. It was, and I may be incorrect on this, but it was my understanding that this would be signed by new members. And one of our code of conduct is unity. If everyone in this room is not willing to sign this, then we shouldn't be expecting it of new members. It's unity. It should be an expectation that we're all willing to step into. That being said, I think it should be simple and straightforward. I changed things to a simple acknowledgement that people have, they acknowledge that they're going to take part in establishing reviewing, they acknowledge that they're supposed to read everything, they acknowledge that they're supposed to attend meetings, and that things may get promulgated from time to time that they're going to have to keep up to speed. I do think it's important that a great many people in this room are elected officials. They took an oath of office, and that oath of office didn't say you will be collaborative, you know, you will represent your community except where you think it conflicts with Dr. Cog. If you have a true conflict, it is part, I mean, you have to be able to voice that here. And maybe in that instance, you may not be collaborative. And you need the right to be able to balance this. And this organization has done that well. And so I've written it in a way that I think people can sign it and still feel that they can keep their oath of office, for those of us who have signed oaths of office. And so I'll present that, and that's my position.
Mayor Rakowski.
You know, most people would agree that the McCarthy era was a shameful and ugly time in American history. But one of the things that came out of that era were loyalty oaths. In 1958, when this organization was in existence, in the case of Spicer versus Randall, the United States Supreme Court ruled that loyalty oaths, at least California's, were unconstitutional. I think this is tantamount to a loyalty oath, and I don't support it having it at all, for the reasons being what my fellow mayor from the South Side, Laura Chrisman, just spoke to in terms of the oath we took, and this is almost could be interpreted as a superseding oath, which I think is without the interest of this organization and the organizations we represent.
I also want to point out that the document that was distributed to the board and that is included in our packet was reviewed by the attorney. He didn't address the issues that the mayor did, but he made some edits as well. And there are copies that are of his edits. And Mayor Chrisman also prepared copies of just for and these are FYIs, people. These are a place to start a discussion, just like the original document was. And I don't expect, so we're going to start handing those out right now. And Jerry, can you hand out Mayor Christmas as well? So,
sure.
So I do think we,
it's two pages, but
we can take. So I guess this is an opportunity for dialogue, folks. I imagine that we are going to send this back to the Structure and Governance Room to take the comments that we're receiving here and make revisions as necessary to the document. So I think it's really important that you, particularly if you're not in the Structure and Governance Group and you have comments regarding this, we'd really like to hear them this evening. So before I go to Structure and Governance Group's members, I am going to ask that any others who would like to opine on the subject, please do so. And if I don't see comments, oh yes, please.
I have no objection to reinforcing the goals of the group, and especially when you're bringing on new members. I guess I don't know what I object to the signature piece of it, because I don't think you get better participation just because somebody has signed it. I think we're all here. Everybody that's in this room is here because they're committed and they participate and you prepare. And I don't think you can better that by having, you know, somebody sign it.
Okay, I'm gonna call. I just want to just differentiate between the documents. The document that has the blue line version is the DRCOG attorney's comments. There is the comment that is gray and black. Just gray and black are some of the comments that Mayor Chrisman worked with Commissioner Partridge and others. I think had seen that as well. There are two pages. The second page of it is just the signature piece. So the meat is on the document. Councilmember Malika.
So I guess this is a question for whoever was on the group or created the document. If a person or a board member refuses to sign, are they not allowed to be on this board? Or I guess what is the repercussions if you choose not to sign this document?
And I don't know that we can answer that tonight, but that is a question that we will have an answer for when we come back, if that's okay with you. Okay,
yeah.
And Councilmember Stoltzman, did you have your...
My question was, what are these documents?
Thank
you for addressing that.
Okay. Okay. Commissioner Partridge.
You know, it's interesting because this board's a little different than our own boards and councils, but it still is a local governing body or is a local public body. But, you know, it's interesting, you know, in I'll quote former chair Jack Hilbert, as he always said, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu, but I add to that. If you don't bring your checkbook to the table, you really don't have much to say, really. So I think really what binds us to this is not a document, but it's, first of all, we are volunteer members. Our organizations choose to join this, and we have to pay to do that. Our signature is on that check, and Dr. Cog's signature is on the back. I think that's what binds us to the point where we already have an obligation. It's already understood. But there's an obligation that comes back. Our check was signed.
Cash, do you mean?
Cash.
Yeah. Yeah. Are there any other comments? Yes, Mayor Jones.
Well, even though I'm leaving, I would say I appreciate the sentiment of what we're trying to achieve here in terms of that there's expectations of board members. And it's kind of a high bar. I mean, this is one of the most active regional bodies around, and there's big packets, and there's a lot of meetings. And I think it's important to signify to people when they come on board that, hey, we expect you to participate. We need you to participate. And I also think there's the other part of that is regionalism, right? That is what makes this work. And so, anyhow, not taking away from what Mayor Chrisman said about our oath of office, I think it's very important, the regionalism concept. If we don't come here with that in mind, we will not get good results. And so, we're handing this back to the governance committee. I guess you'll have some things to wrestle with here, but I wouldn't give up what you're trying to go for, because I do think it's very important.
Yes, Councilmember. You got it?
Yep, thank you.
Thank you.
My concern is, what was, since I'm new here, what was the problem that this is solving?
I'll take a stab, and then I'm going to turn it over to the other members to And I think it's not necessarily a problem, but it was the idea of when you come down to DRCOG, being prepared for meetings, attending the meetings, and the workshops and all of the committees that you sign up to participate in is important. This body is only going to function with good participation from the board members who are, and by participation it was being prepared, being respectful of each other. And I would admit that I actually am very comfortable with the draft that was submitted by Mayor Chrisman, and because I do think it highlights the acknowledgement of the participation, the acknowledgement of the governing principles that really do govern the conduct of this body, and that as part of the responsibility of onboarding or being a member, we should be aware of these are the governing documents. If you have questions about your behavior, go back and reflect and look at those. If you I do believe, and I think Mayor Chrisman does have the comment about the region's success is, you know, this body is vital and collaboration is vital to the region's success. So in my mind, I think it was an acknowledgement. When you come down here, this is who you are supposed to be at this table. And I don't think it means you give up representation of your local government, and I would never want to convey anything in that. But to me, it was that I'm a regional person and thinker when I sit here, and it doesn't mean I'm not caring about my local community at home. And I think sometimes there was a concern that we were moving away a little bit from that, and as new members come on, they should come on with that expectation. And let me allow Mr. Graves to elaborate.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I largely agree with your summary of the focus of this and what motivated it. I think there was also a question of efficiency, though, for all members. So when all of us sort of raise the bar as a body and we're committing and acknowledging our fiduciary responsibility to be prepared when we come, even when we sign the checks, then that shortens the amount of time that we're spending on a lot of issues here. You know, I'm being a member of the capital city, I'm very sensitive to the amount of time that many of you spend on the road driving down to these meetings when you have families at home and lives outside of public service. And so this was just one more sort of opportunity, right, to remind the board that we have an opportunity to really stay focused on our deliverables here and to come prepared.
Thank you. I know, I'm sorry. Mayor Pro Tem Pfeiffer.
And because we do have a few new people and you have great questions, I think we might need to reflect for a minute why the Governance and Structure Committee was put together was to tackle several things. One was dues and fees, voting, should they be weighted, efficiency, committees. We have too many committees. There's probably 20-30% of this board that's probably here 10-15 hours a week.
And that's just me.
Well, every time I call Jackie, she's here, so I know she's here all the time. But I know Phil's here. I know Herb's here. So I think you're trying to tackle different layers, and this is just one of those layers in the onion that we want to make sure that all of us understand that it's very important. Tonight's a full night. I'll be honest. This is a full night. If we go back on attendance, you're going to see there's only this lower table.
Don't tell them that. The expectation is that this is the way
they're right. But the thing is we would like everybody to be here. There's been low nights, and we want people here all the time participating and letting their communities be heard and voiced at this table. You know, and when you don't show up, I agree. With Commissioner Partridge, that if you're not here, you kind of lose out. But we'd like to remember the discussion earlier was to broaden participation. But if we don't set the expectations on that, then how do we broaden participation with the board and many facets of this organization?
Mayor Cernanik.
Thank you, Councilmember Beacom. When you talk about what is the issue that we're trying to solve here. A couple of other points that I'll add to Mayor Pro Tem Pfeiffer's comments, in that historically, Dr. Cog kind of had an apprenticeship approach that you move through from a county or a city where you start off and you are the alternate. And maybe you get to the Metro Vision, the MVIC committee level or some other committee piece. So you kind of move through this apprenticeship before you actually move to being at the adult table, so to speak. And to some extent with term limits and turnover that's been occurring across our various different organizations, probably not as much at the county level, but certainly at the city levels, there's been this significant piece. And so the question is, how do we make sure that there's that expectation absence sometimes where there's an apprenticeship where folks ease into it? How do we make sure, and it's kind of like, not wanting to shake the baby to try and get the knowledge that's there, but actually, and I like Mayor Christman's approach with acknowledgement of the expectations that are there. So commend her and the commissioner on the draft that's there, and I think that's good. But it's how do we, in the onboarding, when you come on, recognizing that some folks just step to the table without having gone through any kind of apprenticeship or a warm-up around those expectations, as opposed to Daniel that spent a lot of time sitting in the alternate seat over there before ever stepping up to the table. And that is a recognition, and that we deal with some important issues impacting the region with the three different hats that the board represents between the MPO, the RPO, and the AAA. So it's trying to say, hey, that's out there.
So I am looking at the clock, and we are a little behind schedule. I know Mayor Rakowski has an additional comment. I am going to suggest to this group, and I know we have not had a chance to really review some the lawyers' edits and then Mayor Christman's edits. I will acknowledge Councilmember Stoltzman, Shakti, Councilmember Beacom, but then I'm going to ask you if there's additional comments that you, again, after you've reviewed these, to please send them to Connie. She will distribute this to the governance and structure group, who will thoughtfully consider all of this, and anyone is invited. We'll make sure you know when that meeting is. Someone who really feels strongly they want to participate in that, we'll make sure everyone knows when that meeting is happening. So Mayor Rakowski, gosh darn it, what order did I say? Shakti, Councilmember Stoltzman, and Councilmember Beacom.
I'll be brief. I would support this as a statement of goals. However, as to the issue of getting people to the table, absolutely want that. But I've been here since late 2003 as an alternate, a member of MVIC, and the prime. We have never, ever had anywhere near close to all the members of this body present. So, and I am not aware of any effort by prior board chairs or the executive director to go out, and maybe they've done this, and speak to those entities that are signed up as being part of Dr. Cog but never show up. So I think that's where we need to start if we want to hear from everybody. This is a classic preaching to the choir. The choir is here listening. Where are the missing members of the congregation? And that's, I think, really what you're trying to get at. And that's where we need to go.
Shakti.
I just wanted to add and talking about what it is to be new to Dr. Cog, that part of what the Governance Committee has looked at and talked to Jennifer about is how do you onboard and educate and make it so that you're prepared, you have the opportunity to be prepared.
Ashley. Councilmember Sultan.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you recognizing that you'll let everyone know when the structure and governance meeting is so we can all attend if we have comments.
Or email them. You don't need to attend, but
that's all right. I have no problem attending meetings, okay. Just to put that out there.
I don't have any problem signing a statement of understanding. I appreciate Mayor Christman taking the time to do edits, but I just want to say that when I started in 2014, I got a really nice, lovely packet from staff. It was very complete. Yeah, it had all the information I could have possibly wanted to know about DRCOG. I received it electronically. I then received it in the mail. And I got the Metro Vision included in there, a bunch of additional contact information. I got phone numbers from Connie. So I just want to recognize that I do think the staff is doing an excellent job providing the information for onboarding, and people have to take the time to read that information. And there's no fast way to digest that. You have to read it. And it's a thick document, and if people can't take personal responsibility for that, I don't think there's anything signing a document will add to that. But I'm happy to sign it. I'm very committed to regionalism, and I think you guys have done a nice job.
Councilmember.
Two comments. One is I didn't really hear that there's a major problem with the members, but maybe with our groups that we represent, not maybe necessarily making sure that their members that they send here are committed to do what they're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. And what I'm used to would be that this would be a memorandum of understanding. This is the level of expectation that we have, and the use of the I word in there is different than just stating it's expected that members will do this, this, and this, and then you sign an acknowledgement that you've read it and you understand it. Sounds much less draconian than just doing it this way. I don't have a problem signing it personally because I have a commitment to perform and do what I need to do here as well as back in the city and county. So it's just that I find that with my background that this seems totalitarian sometimes. So that's where my problem is. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Pfeiffer is going to make a quick comment, and then we are moving on to our last.
We're going to note all this and take it back. And I just have thank you very much, Laura, for putting this together. I like the approach. When we asked staff, just to clarify, when we asked staff to put something on paper, that's what something was. So we weren't set in stone on anything. So we appreciate all the feedback tonight. And the governance committee will get that ironed out the first Wednesday of next month. The last thing, and I just want to ask the board, so when we go work, we're not, you know, we're using our time wisely when we come down here as well, is one topic was maybe there should be an oath when everyone comes in. Urban Drainage does it, and our offices do it. So I'm just putting it out there that, you know, the level of commitment that was discussed. If there's any thoughts or opinions, more than share them with Connie or myself, and we'll make sure we either put an L in that or bring it back.
And to be clear, it is easier if the comments all go to Connie, so then we have one point of contact, and then that's distributed out, because so everyone's operating with the same knowledge level. So to be clear, Connie is going to email out the three separate documents, the original document that was in the packet, the one Mayor Christman edited, and then the one that was edited by the attorney, and she'll differentiate which is which. And if you know, at your leisure, review those and provide comment, and also included in that will be the date of the next structure governance meeting. And if you think you're going to attend, please let us know, because we don't meet in a large room. February 2 to 4. It will be in the email as well. Okay, and I appreciate the thorough discussion on this, and I think I know it's been a long meeting, but it's been a worthwhile discussion, so thank you. We are now going to move on to our informational briefings, presentation on the balanced scorecard progress and quick score. Mr. Stiegel, is attachment M in your packets? And I've got to get water if I'm going to keep talking.
All right. So let me step over here. I'm just going to hit these really quickly. As Jennifer said in her opening comments, there's a lot of heavy lifting when it comes to designing strategy. And we've been doing it over a year and a half, It takes time. Only the best organization will ever invest in it, is in my opinion. I know Arapaho County has done it. I know certainly know Douglas County has done it. It's a lot of work, but I think it's well worth it. So what I'm going to clip through is QuickScore, our balanced scorecard software, and I'm going to just hit the high levels of all the scorecards just so you kind of get a glimpse of what QuickScore is going to share for us. Okay, yes, that's right. So in the what we've done is in working in the last year and a half, we adopted the balanced scorecard framework. This is for the new members. And in working with at the DRCOG level, we designed a scorecard for DRCOG, and then we cascade, is the term, through divisions, throughout the divisions. So we actually just align the organization through that one top-level scorecard. So each division will look at that and decide how they play in that sandbox. How do we support that? You know, what do we do? And that strategy develops in that way. So as you'll see, we have the DRCOG scorecard, and we have several. So that's the top-level look. It tells us a lot of stuff at the top level. You'll get scoring, color scoring, and things of that nature. But I'm going to move ahead because I realize we're out of time. So if I go to the next scorecard, admin and finance, administration and finance, that orange is just for Roxy. She's a Bronco fan. So I changed the line graph to that color. So there's some measure data in there, but there's not a lot of measure data in the scorecard yet. That's the next thing. As you heard Brad about performance measures, that'll be the next thing we start doing is populating scorecards. So I will clip through, pardon me, I'll clip through the next one. So the next one will be the Area Agency on Aging, and we don't have data in there. Some of these scorecards were designed later in the sequence, so we're backfilling. So it will look populated at one time when we can get there, pardon me. Communications and Marketing scorecard. Okay, again, no data at this stage. We may have a little. Let me go back a range. We can go back in QuickScore. So I'm going to go back and show you what it might look like. No, there is no data in there. Okay. Well, you know. But we're going to see something fancy coming up. RPO, Regional Planning and Operations scorecard is operational in QuickScore. And I'm going to go to the last one so Mr. Rex can brag a little. So I don't want him to brag too much. That's one measure. That's all right now. Yeah, he wasn't.
Obviously, the bar's not
high. It's not. And I'd say we got to take that up to like 20 for him. But that's one metric you'll see down in skilled workforce that we've added some measure data. And so some of you are familiar with it, but that is QuickScore. It allows us to develop dashboards and things of that nature that'll keep us focused on the strategy. And if you remember in your mind's eye the model that Brad was talking about, one of those components is refinement, and that's what it's all about. It's not a set it and forget it, but it is a refining process of learning.
I think this is a nice introduction. I think I probably need to digest it a little bit.
I'm sure.
We'll be seeing this again.
Yes, a lot.
Excuse me, my mic wasn't turned on. So I was just suggesting, I know this is a lot, and there's really not a lot of data behind it, so I think this is a nice introduction. We'll be getting more data later. There's probably more questions than answers right now, so I'm going to suggest we move on, unless we have someone that has a burning desire to delve a little deeper. Okay, we've got our committee reports. I'm going to request that these reports be brief, reflect decisions made, and information germane to the business of DRCOG. We're going to start out with the State Transportation Advisory Committee, Commissioner Jones.
So I couldn't attend because it was the same time as RAC, but Doug Rooks provided some brief notes. The peak period shoulder lanes on I-70 have been open since November, and CDOT's working on that. The Freight Advisory Council is up and running, and it's really the opportunity for STAC and industry to work together on freight, which will be an increasingly important issue. CDOT starting development of its statewide plan and is reaching out to stakeholders on that. And then we got an update on state and federal legislation, but I think you've already heard about all of them. So, and then last but not least, CDOT's developing a database of major investment needs as part of its 10-year development program.
Okay, moving on. Metro Mayor Caucus, Mayor Noon.
All right. Metro Mayors had their annual retreat just a couple Saturdays ago down at DU, and it was a great gathering. We also have a fair amount of new mayors that we were getting up to speed. So with that, we heard quite a bit, an update on Building Better Colorado, on transportation, some exciting things. Of course, the Don Hunt project that came to us as well. We got updates on some of the legislative issues that we've been following. We have a homelessness, water committee, some of our other things that we kind of decided that we were going to continue to work through for the next year, and kind of got our work plan set out for the year. So with that, I can tell you that we'll be following the urban renewal TIF discussions again, if construction defects comes up again, some of those same things that we've talked about in the past, and of course whatever may come up in transportation, and we're following the SCFD funding reallocation as well. So a number of things going on. Our next meeting's the 3rd, so we'll have more in February. And once again, thanks to all our new mayors that spent the day with us. It was great.
Thank you. Metro Area County Commissioners, Don.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to look at Elise, too. I believe our next meeting is coming up this Friday. So our last meeting actually was the joint meeting with Metro Mayor's Caucus. We had a legislative meeting at the Arts Museum just across the street here. It was a great time to meet with our legislators, some that have been around a while and some are brand new. So it was a great time to mix and mingle and bring to their attention some of those combined concerns that we have, whether you be a city or a county.
Good. Excellent.
All right. We are moving on. Report of the Advisory Committee on Aging, Jayla Sanchez Warren.
Okay. So for those of you who are new, we spent a great deal of time at the Advisory Committee talking about the area plan on aging. Every 4 years, every AAA in the country has to do an area plan on aging. It sets goals, basically, performance goals. So in the next 4 years, in a nutshell, it's much more detailed, we need to increase the number of people served. We need to increase access to services, increase resources, of course, in order to provide those, increase service to the unserved and the underserved, fill gaps in service areas. So one of the things that we're working on here at DRCOG is developing maps of gaps in services, like where are there food deserts and where are there transportation problems. For our services, Broomfield is way underserved. We need to work to identify those and then work to fill those gaps. We set performance measures for our internal programs as well as for our contractors. And that's a big change for us, and we'll be monitoring those, and you will see those on our dashboard. I wanted to let you know that we had one contractor, so for those people who are new, we fund about 40 different services and 30 different service providers. One of those service providers turned back their contract. It was Arapaho Douglas Mental Health. We had funded them for $95,000 in counseling services. They were not able to do it, and they sent us a letter saying that they were going to return the money. And so what we have to do now is we've already talked to all of our service providers. We have a process to then redistribute the money back out to the community and our service providers. So we're in the process of doing that. We also celebrated and acknowledged, but we acknowledged and we will be celebrating next month. Two of our advisory committee members have been on the advisory committee for 20 years. Fabian Watrous from Clear Creek County and Bob Lanky from Jeffco. So we will be having a party for them and acknowledging their service, long, long time service to the advisory committee and to making this a better place to age.
Thank you.
And that's also, we still need two more board members to join the advisory committee for all of those who are new. Sally. No.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Regional Air Quality Council, it says Jackie Millay, but it's going to be Elise Jones.
So just a couple of things. One, RAC announced a grant pool for local agency air quality projects. They have $380,000 for the for a two-year period, and then we'll have a subsequent two-year period, $380,000 as well. And the projects anywhere from $50,000 to $125,000 for local government programs to improve air quality. So it's an opportunity. I think of note there, the RAC has been successful in negotiating a single contract with CDOT that will then allow the RAC to disperse small grants to local governments. That might be something that Dr. Cog can figure out how to do that with CDOT as well, because we've been stymied in that, I think, or we haven't worked out how to do that. So if RAC can do it, surely we can. As you know, the EPA has set a new ozone standard of 70 parts per billion, but the plans associated with that will be a couple years down the road. The RAC is working now on meeting the 75 parts per billion 2008 standard, which we are out of compliance with. So we got an update on the state implementation plan process for us getting into attainment and resubmitting. And a lot of the work that the RAC's doing now is in three different subcommittees that are looking at specific strategies we can use to meet attainment of the 75 parts per billion standard. There's a station area, an area source subcommittee, a transportation and land use subcommittee, and a mobile sources and fuels subcommittee. So we're all split up and working on those strategies. So that will hopefully feed into the attainment plan that we'll be submitting in the next year.
Thank you, Elise. And the E-470 Authority, Mayor Rakowski.
Briefly, there's a new director who's been hired, Tim Stewart, who is formerly the head of the Oklahoma Turnpike Commission, and we have a special liaison with him named Doug Rex.
Yeah.
And lastly, in the area of transportation funding, new construction, one of the missing pieces in the metro area is the disconnection of one end of 6th Avenue Parkway with the other. And in this regard, the authority, E-470 Authority, has made an outright contribution of $2 million to the city of Aurora to complete this, and additionally a loan of $2 million to help Aurora with the funding. So this is a way that Aurora is going to get it done. And maybe there are other places that other people can use a similar plan, and that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Report on fast tracks, Mr. Van Meter.
So earlier this month, RTD opened the Flatiron Flyer service on US 36. Substantially, it's working well in a few places. The demand has exceeded our expectations. We immediately added a trip to try to address some of that over demand, and that additional trip was not enough last night. Our board did approve four additional trips in the AM and PM from Westminster Center, which will help both Westminster Center service as well as service throughout the corridor by relieving loads throughout. And so we're responding quickly to the success of the opening. The success will be improved even more if the House Bill 16-1008 roadway shoulder access for buses is approved by the legislature, signed by the governor. So I appreciate the support Dr. Cog, this body, provided towards that bill, because it will help operations on that corridor as well as noted during the discussion statewide. That's the first of five projects, as people know, that RTD will be opening this year as part of the Fast Tracks program. There was no Fast Tracks board meeting this month at RTD. That concludes my update.
Thank you. With that, I'm going to just make note of the informational items that are in your packet. Rich Morrow did let you know about the federal legislative policy, Attachment N, the transmittal of the nominating committee report, Attachment O, EPA's response to the Dr. Cog letter regarding background ozone. We all should be reading that, folks. It's Attachment P in the packet. The annual listing of obligated projects for fiscal year 2015. Attachment Q, and clippings and other communications of interest in Attachment R. Our next meeting is February 17th. Have a happy Valentine's Day, everyone. Are there any other matters by members? Yes.
Our community just wants to reach out to Denver Fire Chief Eric Tate's incident this week is unfortunate. He's also a former city council member of Thornton, and wow. Just want to, you know, acknowledge what a crazy world we live in.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
Okay. Councilmember Stoltzman.
Yeah, the city of Louisville just wanted to thank Parker. We were able to go on a tour of some of their city facilities, and it is fantastic down there. Their staff's amazing. The town is amazing. The facilities are wonderful. So we had a chance to go see them, and if anyone else has a chance to, it's really great. We saw the rec center in the field house and drove around some of the other areas, and nice. It's just amazing.
Great. All right, I just want to say, Mayor Jones, we're going to miss you. And we are looking forward to the, yeah. And we hope we'll see you popping around here and there. So anyway, with that, we are adjourned, folks. Thank you. Mm-hmm.